We're just trying to change the world here, people.
Oh, really?
The Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing that you took that as an insult.
You mean true for you is different from true for anybody else?
Yeah, absolutely, because I can't
think either got to be true or not.
I can't, no.
Good evening, citizens of Netlandia. Welcome to ORLY Radio 123, recorded Friday, August 26th, 2016, where we dismantle the current events for your edutainment through mostly rational conversations that make you say, oh, really? I'm your host, Andy Cowen, and I have my usual suspects. I've got Daniel Atherton and Stephen Griffith, not in that order.
We're in whatever order we please.
Exactly. Welcome back, gentlemen. Before we get into the show, you might have noticed that we're a week late. That's because last week, life intervened, and I was too freaking exhausted to go through all the stories that that the world had to offer. And oh boy, did the world have to offer some stuff. You're going to see that tonight. Though most of it is actually present with this week, because it was more important. But yeah, sometimes things like that happen, so sorry. Terribly sorry for being human, but hey, we're back. No, we have not gone away. So yes, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus or whatever. So, one additional item. No, I don't have any notes from previous weeks or anything like that, but friend of the show, Bill Hunsaker, he is also a fellow podcaster, and he's been on the show previously as well. He's having some issues. He's having some difficulties with his current living situation, and he has a GoFundMe out there, and he's looking for a very modest $400 just for moving expense. He managed to secure the other $2,600 that he was actually seeking to try and actually get himself into a place and not on the street. So good on him for managing that. And I will then have a link in the show notes and also out on our Facebook page to go, you know, buy him a cup of coffee. You know, you can do worse with $5, people. You can definitely make an impact in somebody's life that really he would like to change the world, like many of us. So if you can help him, you're helping change the world. So congratulations, and then you can feel good about that. So without further ado, oh God, we have kind of a theme tonight. I stumbled on a Reddit World News thread, and there's some really heinous things going on out there, in addition to just crazy, you know what? We may have the explicit tag on for this one, because there's just enough stuff. So here is your trigger warning. If you do not wish to have our voices go out to the little ears and offend them and your sensibilities with naughty adult language.
Let's go with heinous and exercises in abject stupidity.
Yeah, there you go. Then perhaps you want to skip. I'll give you time. Okay. There's some crazy batshittery out there. I mean, it's ridiculous, some of the stuff that's going on. I don't know that I can contain myself any further. So let's get into it. First, the first thing that popped up in my feed was some news out of Japan. It seems that their biggest pension fund, the biggest pension fund in the world, lost $52 billion.
How?
Their stock market crashed, basically. Yeah, you didn't really hear about that, did you?
No.
Yeah.
Well, you know, after what happened with something we'll address later on.
Yeah.
Their stock market crash.
It's a little bit ridiculous here. So Japan's government pension investment fund, the GPIF, has posted a loss of $52 billion for April to June following the tumbling Tokyo stock market and the yen's surge. The value of the fund's assets dropped $1.3 trillion last quarter. That's $1.3 trillion in a quarter, wiping out the gains the GPIF made since October 2014 when it revised its investment strategy to put more money into stocks and foreign bonds. Good idea, right? No, not so much. So the decline is another disappointment for the fund after a reported loss of 3.8% for the year end in March, worst performance since the financial crisis in 2008. Concerns over the U.S. economic outlook, shocker, as well as the UK's vote to quit the European Union, significantly hurt the global equity markets, boosting demand for Japanese currency, which was seen as a haven for investors in a time of economic uncertainty. As a result, the yen surged against other currencies, reducing the value of overseas assets by 7.8%. The results of the UK's referendum, this is in quotey voice, turned out to be different from what the market expected, and U.S. unemployment data in May was much worse than forecast. Norito Takashi, the president of the GPIF, said in a statement. Moreover, the fund's domestic shares dropped 7.4%. Basically, it's just bad news after bad news after bad news. They lost so much money.
Now, my question is, why didn't they have any sort of like safety net or brakes on this to keep to safeguard essentially a pension plan?
Well, it's probably because they revised their investment strategy. They probably did before.
They probably had safeguards before.
Yeah.
And then just lost them.
And then they decided to put all of their eggs into the stock market. Yeah.
It's just.
And of course, foreign bonds, which, you know, were seen to be a stable solution at the time.
Oh.
Well, they were in 2014.
Remember, yeah, in 2014 they were.
Everything's a gamble.
Right. Especially so, in the stock market. So
any form of speculation is a gamble.
Mm-hmm. So that was a lot of money for our Japanese friends. Just bye-bye. What more is there to say? It's just, it's gone.
And it's gone.
Yeah. So that's a knockdown effect from the Brexit and, of course, some of our craziness here in the United States.
Well, again, the Brexit we have not felt the end of the Brexit.
Exactly. Welcome, Mama Van. Welcome back to the show. Sorry about last week. Yes, you are slightly late to this week, but that's okay. You're just following on the odds that we were going to be late, which we were a little bit late, but just not as late lately. Anyway, so moving right along. So Iran's been kind of a thorn in, I don't know, nearly everyone's side lately. But specifically the U.S., we have a very interesting tenuous relationship with them, don't we? You know, whether it be a $400 million deal that coincided with the release of some nationals. I say coincided as opposed to a ransom, which, you know, some people would like to look at it as.
If you want some interesting cloak and dagger, crazy history, look at the history between the U.S. and Iran.
Oh, yeah.
There's actually a decent academic book. Again, everything's through perspective, so keep your filters up.
Yeah.
It's called Shah of Shahs.
Shah of Shahs.
It's worth a read to get at least perspective and insight on our relationship and why our relationship is the way it is with Iran.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good. We need to pull up a link and drop it in the show notes for us so that people can go take a look at that. In the meantime, let's talk about what happened. So apparently, Iranian military ships charge with weapons out and ready and armed and all that good stuff at a U.S. Navy destroyer. I don't think that was necessarily the brightest idea that I've ever heard.
No.
So four Iranian military vessels sped close to a U.S. Navy guided missile destroyer with their weapons uncovered in the Strait of Hormuz in an, quote, unsafe and unprofessional encounter, a U.S. defense official said on Wednesday. The USS Nitz shot warning flares, sounded its whistles, and attempted unsuccessfully to communicate with the Iranian boats during Tuesday's incident. Tuesday's incident. Oh, yes. Okay. The official said on Wednesday about the incident on Tuesday. The official told AFP, Associated Field Press. I don't. What is AFP? AFP. What organization is AFP?
No,
it's not Associated Press. Well,
I don't think it's that.
We'll figure that out. But
Associated Foreign Press?
Maybe. There is a... I actually pulled up another one. Let's see. That's a little bit better.
Well, it is a global news agency.
Okay, so the USS Squall... transit, let's see. So just one day after video emerged of Iranian ships swarming and harassing the USS Nitz, Business Insider has confirmed a separate incident on Wednesday. So there was an incident on Tuesday with the Nitz, and then on Wednesday involving the USS Squall, a coastal patrol ship in the Northern Arabian Gulf. Commander Bill Urban of the U.S. Navy's 5th Fleet told Business Insider that several incidents occurred where Iranian Navy ships showed wanton disregard for safety and internationally recognized maritime law. The USS Tempest and the USS Squall were, quote, operating in international waters in the Northern Arabian Gulf, where three Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps Navy vessels approached at high speed. The vessels veered within 600 yards. That's spitting distance. Of the yep. U.S. Navy ships, despite auditory and visual warnings from their crews. Later on, Urban says a Nasser-class fast attack craft charged the Tempest and came within 200 yards. At this point, the Tempest fired three flares at the Iranian vessel.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, escalation, perhaps? I mean, that just, it sounds all sorts of bad.
It's primarily something like this is saber-rattling the, oh, look at us, we're going to play a somewhat dangerous game of chicken without actually threatening things. They're trying to show, again, they're trying to show the power they have, and it's probably dealing a lot more with domestic politics and stuff like that going on. The problem is, one of these days, one of those little captains on those ships is going to get think a lot more of themselves than they think, or think the U.S. isn't going to react, and they're going to get a lot closer, a lot faster, or they're going to ignore the warnings, and their boat is going to get sunk.
Yeah.
Because after the incident with the USS Cole, the U.S. don't play.
Oh.
Yeah, so the Squall resorted to firing three warning shots from 50 cals. Which caused them to turn away, but two of the same craft from the second encounter harassed the guided missile destroyer USS Stout. There was another. So there was the Squall, the Stout, and what else? The Tempest, and the Nitz. So four of our Navy ships have been harassed.
This
nice looking ship.
This is not going to play well, especially in the Defense Committee and the Senate when this report comes out.
Cyclone class patrol ship.
Yeah, these are. It's interesting. I'm trying to pull up the video because there's video of them harassing. Oh, that's a tiny little boat too. You guys are idiots for doing this.
Well, they were hoping to create an international.
This is USS. This is UBTM reporting from the Southern Arabian.
Then all of a sudden, you know, fire the 50.
I'm saying they're trying to create an international incident. I'd say just to get more. Essentially, what China is doing in the South China Sea and the Philippines.
Yeah, and what Russia has been doing.
Same thing across the Strait of Hormuz. Going, look at us. You know, we have some power here, you know, not necessarily unlike China being able to truly project that power, more, you know, more the Mr. Universe, let me get on stage and flex a bit at this big giant U.S. ship. Unfortunately, said U.S. don't play.
Yeah.
Again, I'm looking at these boats.
It's like, what did you think you're going to do?
The 50 caliber deck gun could clear those boats.
Yeah. Again, they're not designed for... They're essentially brown water craft and shallow water craft, unlike, you know, a destroyer. the patrol boats also are actually fairly shallow water-ish craft.
Yeah.
But they can operate a lot deeper in a lot worse weather than those little things can.
I'm just going, if I were on one of those boats, I would not be antagonizing a U.S. Navy craft.
No.
For those people who are playing along at home, what the Iranians had is essentially, if you've ever been on any form of, you know, intercoastal or any water area, and you've watched the Marine Patrol go around, like a sheriff's boat.
These are essentially sheriff's boats, four of those. But in international waters. So they're way out there. I mean, they're lucky that the seas are pretty flat. I mean, really. But with
the sea through there is actually pretty calm usually.
Yeah, well, that's good for them. But looking at the, I've got a cycling GIF here, and it's the vantage point. Just, they're very high in comparison to the little low boats.
Yeah.
So, it's rare on water to have a high ground advantage, but they do. So, yeah, this is just dumb. Why are you guys
fire,
bothering?
You can fire downrange, and it's not a fair fight. My mind doesn't wrap around it right now.
Yeah. So, continuing on with being in Iran.
Don't want to be.
Iran arrests hundreds of Instagram and WhatsApp users. Also, Telegram, which is an encrypted service.
I'm not surprised. I'm really not.
Yeah. So it says here that users of apps such as Telegram and WhatsApp have been targeted. Instagram, Telegram, and WhatsApp. Quote, these people were carrying out immoral activities, insulted religious beliefs, or had illegal activities in the field of fashion. Illegal activities in the field of fashion.
Okay.
Should be like a badge of honor with some of the people I know. I mean, they would wear that with pride.
Beyond that, I'm going, okay, so Iran actually has fashion police.
They do.
Well, if I may, this is another means of locking up political prisoners. This is how you get your opposition, is have laws on your books where you can target anyone for doing illegal fashion things, as funny as we say it, but immoral activities, anything where it's a subjective law.
Yeah.
And this is how you lock up dissent.
In May, In May, a committee headed by President Hussein Rouhani is said to have set a one-year deadline for foreign social media to hand over data on their Iranian users.
Yeah, good luck.
That's not good.
Also, that's not going to happen.
I'm sorry.
Facebook and Twitter are banned.
Yeah.
Which, of course, means they are incredibly actively used in the countries.
More than half of Iran's 80 million populace is online, at least. So that means, you know, a good chunk of them.
A good bit of the cat's out of the bag. This is one of the things where I'd like to have some of our listeners, viewers, you guys out in Netland. I know a little bit about how China, you know, they have their own internet. It's a different world if you live in China.
The Great Firewall of China.
You're allowed to have access to. I do not know how that operates in Iran. I know that there's filters.
Well, let me tell you.
But I don't know the degrees.
Let me tell you a little bit what happens there. Since the internet is a government-controlled apparatus, there are things called border domain controllers, border gateways, where internet service providers then connect in, and those border gateways are controlled by the government. Everything from everyone in the entire country, unless they've got like a sat phone or something, goes through those gateways. I mean, they can also act as a man in the middle and then capture packets, because also what they'll typically do is they'll manage to get a trusted site certificate onto the user's device. And if you're getting something within the country in order to possibly sell it, then you have to put a government certificate on it in order to sell it in many cases. One of the biggest examples of that was the Hong Kong Post Office was a trusted site certificate in Windows for decades, it seemed, until finally it was removed. And that means that any traffic that they wanted to, they had a key where they could open it up because they were a trusted site certificate. So they could act as a man in the middle and re-sign a document that was going through. Open it up, look everything, and then send it on its merry way back to where it was going. Man-in-the-middle attacks are very difficult to thwart, so you have to have end-to-end encryption. So Telegram is supposed to be end-to-end encrypted software. WhatsApp is also end-to-end encryption. Instagram, not so much, just all the kids love it. So that's why we heard those two were being, you know, currently used, because they managed to somehow find out these people are using these encrypted services, therefore they're breaking the law.
We have to crack down.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's a totalitarian state. That's what you do. So if you are the one that's running the internet, then you do have some control over it. It's like trying to do something on your work computer in the work building where you are. It's their hardware. You're just using it, and it's going through their internet connection. They can do what they will with it, and you would be you'd mostly be unwise to it.
In truth, they're actually authoritarian. They're not totalitarian.
Oh, I'm so sorry. My nomenclature was slightly off.
It's me and the political scientist going,
No.
Nope, I have to correct it.
Please do. Every time, please do. So, enough about Iran, because we're going to hear about them again. And again, and again, because they're a country, and it's a thing. Okay, so on to Germany.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, this is a fun one, isn't it? So, apparently there was an assassination attempt against their prime minister, Angela Merkel.
She's not a very popular lady right
now. No. There were some, in this, this is a terrible website. Just to let you know, the Daily Star.
Oh, ow.
It's a terrible, terrible website. However...
They also picked the worst picture they could have for her.
Oh, no, there's a lot more. Hang on.
It's deliberate. Oh, it hurts.
Yeah, well, hang on. Yes. She actually looks a little bit like Igor there with a hump. I mean, I know she's...
Actually a little bit like Gerard Depardieu in drag.
Oh, wow. Okay. Where's the lie, though?
Where's the lie?
Yeah. So,
I feel bad for saying it, but it's the truth.
Yeah, we don't want to assassinate someone's physical appearance, but she's making it really easy. Just saying. Okay, so moving right along. Somebody tried to kill her, and they were actually thinking that it may have been an attempted kidnapping plot as well, according to this. But check out this lovely image. Let me see if I can make that bigger for you. Whoa, that's wrong. That's as big as it's going to get there. Okay, there we go. German gifts for Europe. Nazism, Islam. Why, Angela? So what I'm seeing in the scattering of news that I managed to pull this evening for the show notes is... Nearly every country in Europe that has a strong conservative bend is insane about Islam.
Yeah.
They're absolutely insane about it.
I hate to put on my tinfoil, but I've been having a number of conversations with people that I know and trust, and it's this thing of history repeating itself. We have a religious minority that is being targeted. Now, part of that is because of the rise of Daesh, and foreign and domestic terrorism on the rise throughout Europe. Though most of these individuals are not religious, they're just angry young men who have no outlet and apparently no hope. But is making this one religious minority, and now we're having refugees fleeing from the Middle East, and this group is being targeted because they're the foreigners. And it's not pretty, and it's getting worse.
Yeah, and we then move just kind of adjacent to Germany and talk to Austria
and
here.
This is ugly.
Yeah, Austria is... They are currently controlled by a more conservative government. And they are also talking about following Britain's lead.
And an auxit.
An auxit, yes. I'm just looking at my soundboard like, do I have an auxit jack? I think I do have an auxit jack. but anyway, puns aside. So they're basically, they're heavily complaining Merkel's refugee policy about Syrian refugees. German Chancellor's weekend-do-it approach to refugee crisis is irresponsible as it lures more migrants to Europe instead of capping their numbers. Austria's defense minister said calling on European leaders to promptly convene a summit on deportation. This is not a policy if Europe stays here in agony and sticks its head in the sand. Hans-Peter Doskoll, who is also a member of the ruling Social Democratic Party, told Austria's Krone newspaper in an interview published Thursday, referring to what he believes is the lack of political will in Europe to offer viable solutions to the crisis instead of repeating past mistakes. It sounds an awful lot like Trump.
Not only does it sound like a lot like Trump, again, beating my historical book,
mm-hmm.
It just replace Muslim with Jew.
Yes.
Beyond that, it's also looking how it's written, the idea of the luring migrants to Europe. Because, mm-hmm. you know, we they have to be lured there. It's not the fact that all their houses are being blown to shit.
Yeah, there's,
and they're trying there's to, well, I don't know, war going on.
Nothing for them to live
in. It's not like they're trying to, now they're trying to, like, you know, get someplace where they can just get, you know, a meal a day.
Mm-hmm. And we've seen this before, too. You know, remember Bosnia?
Yeah. But, but there was a difference in journalistic coverage of that war than what we're seeing in Syria. Also,
we had some real journalists then, too.
Well, we had real journalism, but The Serbian conflict, while the U.S. there was involvement, it was primarily we had NATO involvement in Serbia. Russia didn't really have its hands anywhere near the Serbian conflict, even though it was right in their backyard. We were dealing with a different Russia back then.
I think it's also more than that. You bring up good by bringing up the Serbian conflict, but one of the key things I would say is the difference between the Serbian conflict and what we're seeing here is primarily the Serbian conflict was a war of genocide, as groups were trying to literally wipe the other one completely out.
Well, it was leftovers all the way from...
Let's help with that. We saw that somewhat with this stuff, not necessarily directly in Syria, but more in Iraq with the Yazidis. When Daesh went in there and tried to wipe them all out, we went, okay, no, we're going to land helicopters on this mountain if we have to and pull these people off and get them to safety.
Yeah.
But if it's just – you're just regular people happening to be being killed in a war zone, well, no, sorry, you're not special enough.
Of course not. No.
Well, also, another thing was The Serbian conflict was fallout from the breakup of the USSR and Yugoslavia being a artificially created nation by the Eastern Bloc, going, you guys will play nice because we say so.
Right, yeah.
And then when with the fall of the USSR, the fall of the Big Brother going, no, you exist, to everyone going, well, we don't want to be together anymore.
It's like, we may exist, but you put us next to people we hate.
Yeah.
And a lot of it is leftovers, not from World War II, but World War I.
Yeah. That was the Yugoslavian conflict, as opposed to what we're seeing here in Syria.
Yeah.
Which is a grand melange of conflicts drawn into a specific theater.
That's certainly a colorful way to put that. Yeah.
There's a number of proxy battles going on all at the same time.
I was just thinking shitstorm. I mean,
I was trying I don't want to be the reason for the explicit tag, but I'm fine with the explicit tag.
It's my show. It's my show. Yeah, it's fine. No, it's a shitstorm over there. And they're trying to get away from it without it hitting the fan and then getting on everybody else.
Well, this is where a number of things I would like to happen. I don't see it happening, which is that the world goes, hey, there's people suffering here. Let's all share the load responsibly and be good citizens about this, good citizens of the world. But that's not going to happen.
No, what we have is the concept of NIMBY, not in my backyard. You know, it can be in your backyard, but I don't want it in my backyard.
Yeah, there are people without homes, and most of these refugees are women, children, the elderly. The young, able-bodied men, you know, those people that you see as a threat, they're dying or they're dead. You're dealing with women, children, and maybe old men and women. These are the people who are trying to find a life.
Yeah.
We can let them in our shores. They're not a threat.
But they obviously are a threat because they have ideas that are different. And really, it's less that they're a threat and more that they are something that
different.
They can
they're the foreigner.
Not even that. In the world of politics, they are simply the fulcrum for the lever. It doesn't matter who they are or where they are from. They are a means to an end. They are something to rally behind to hate.
This is the bread and circuses, folks. This is what you need to. Anyone who goes, hi, look at the shiny, is trying to rob you.
Yeah. So, I mean, let's take, for instance, here. Far-right Austrian Freedom Party. The Austrian Freedom Party.
Yes, these sound like reasonable people.
Freedom Party. Now, here in the States,
any country, any place, a party that has to say we're the Freedom Party, or any country that has to say we're democratic, probably isn't.
Yeah. China's democratic, right? Right? Yeah. I think they are. Yeah.
People's Republic.
Yeah. So I'm noticing that there is this call to freedom as an idea. And they're trying to get people that love freedom to rally to them. And we've seen things like this happen before. In many cases, they wore Klan uniforms. Or perhaps their freedom was only freedom for the slave owners. You know, there was always this call to arms on behalf of freedom. And it seems to be a consistent theme with these conservative, and I hate to use the word conservative because they're not conserving anything.
No, they're far right.
Yeah. But it still is the same banner.
Far-fetched ideas, folks. Anyone that's on the far side, it's just like the comic. It's a bunch of absurdity.
I love The Far Side. Gary Larson was my hero. Okay, so I think that's enough of that. But with this, they're talking the same way that the far right party in Britain,
the Tories, which were in power.
Yeah. They wanted to get out of the EU. So Austria, they're wanting to ox it. They want to get out too.
Wow.
Are they not paying attention to the things that that's doing globally?
Here's where there's a slight difference, because they're probably going after the same things those that engineered the Brexit were truly after, and they got their hands caught in the cookie jar. The more and more we're actually getting real journalism coming out from the UK about Brexit, is those that put together this idea didn't think the vote was going to go their way. They didn't think that they'd pull the wool over enough people's eyes for it to actually happen. They just wanted a rallying cry and something to go like, hey, we wanted this and the opposition stopped us, and something for them to platform on so they could maintain power, and for those people who were engineering the Brexit to take leadership roles.
Yeah.
Then they actually, they did it. And now it's blown up in their faces. What this looks like from the outside is they want the same thing that those engineers, the Brexit, wanted. They want to have a vote. They want it to fail. And then they want to campaign on that opposition.
Hmm. So I followed the rabbit hole a little bit.
Okay.
So Hoffer said that, quote, he very much advocates the demand, end quote, to break off the EU accession talks with Turkey. So is Turkey trying to get into the EU?
Yes, they have been. They have had
that
been
was
for
one
a
of
while.
The things that caused that's got Russia worried.
Well, Russia started, you know, putting on the big boy pants, making noise. But the idea of Turkey coming in now after the failed coup and how Erdogan is just locking up any sort of opposition, and we're having political prisoners left and right. I mean, we have people who had no real provable ties to the coup being locked up that are just academics and journalists. So Turkey's not going to get into the EU, folks.
It doesn't look like it, yeah.
Happening anytime soon.
Huh. Interesting. And an Austrian court cancels the presidential election results? And orders a rerun?
Not LA.
Yeah, this was in July, July 1st.
Okay, so this is a bit old news.
Well, yeah, but, you know, again, world news sometimes takes a while to actually trickle into the American consciousness because we're stupid. So, Fair. Looking at this, so the Austrian Constitutional Court has ruled that the presidential election must be held again. The vote, which took place on May 22nd, saw far-right candidate Norbert Hofer narrowly lose by just 31,000 votes, with Alexander Van Braalen claiming victory. Hofer, who is running for the Freedom Party, learned of the ruling halfway through giving an interview to Russia Today. Yeah, I guess that's what it is. And even afforded himself a brief smile as the news began to sink in, as he was congratulated by his fellow FPO colleague. So it's a court challenge by him. So he's the one that's out in front of all of this, making a lot of noise and trying to stir the pot.
He wants to win.
Yeah.
And there's a...
Sounds like he figures he should have won.
Well, he is marking himself the same as Trump is, which is on fear of the foreign.
Yeah.
And you can blame all of our economic troubles on these people.
This is interesting. So what we're seeing globally is this rise of insanity.
an appeal to fear.
Yeah.
And that's what we're seeing.
And they are all using the fulcrum of ISIS, of Daesh, of ISIL, of Islamic terrorism. Extreme Islamic terrorism. Sunday, Sunday, Sunday at the Super Bowl. No, that kind of thing. Just so they're all using that as the crux. I'm noticing significant themes here.
Yeah. And it's the interesting thing is you're seeing it in Western culture.
Yeah.
This is not something that is heavily being used as a political fulcrum in the East, at least to my knowledge.
Well, it's the West being afraid of the Middle East. And fearing, I think mostly, contamination.
I don't know if it's contamination. I think it's more...
I think they're coming from
the women and children.
I think as we move to France and the Burkini incident, I think you may see it slightly differently. How's that for a segue? So the Burkini is a bathing suit that is designed for Islamic, for Muslim women to remain modest. It is not the full hijab, but is the burqa, so their face is open. Their face is exposed. Now, I am by far not an expert on the exact customs and which scarf goes with which religion, but I try my best. So I will
here's
be
one
as
of the funny things. I before we even tap on the story.
Yes.
There are two things that I have...
Only
three.
Only two?
That I found...
Keep going.
It keeps... I'll get to 10 eventually.
It piles on.
that I have found just... Not... Trying to ignore the story I have come across.
Yeah.
One.
Mm-hmm.
The sales of the burkini are through the roof.
Yes.
Two.
They actually don't look bad. A lot of them are very stylish, I will say. Some of the ones I've seen.
This is, once again, religions, governments, and mostly men trying to regulate what women can wear.
On both sides of the equation. Both sides.
Yep. And three, there's a really cool wealthy guy that's paying for people's fines.
Yes. That's in there, too.
You mentioned the fact that sales are through the roof. I actually read an interview with the people who started and designed the burkini in the first place. And they say actually over 80% of the people who purchase them aren't Muslim. They're women with, like, you know, maybe skin cancer issues or, you know, wanting to protect their skin or have other problems with being out, you know, exposed to the sun. And they're like, hey, look, I can now go to the beach and be protected.
Yeah. They're perfect for gingers.
There's also, it's sort of, for all of our wonderful hipster callbacks, to the older style swimwear of you know, the Victorian age.
Yeah.
Vaudeville age, yeah.
Oh, boy,
we
that
can
Victorian
get steampunk
swimmer.
With our bathing.
Yes, but with modern
sunbathing.
But with modern fabrics that actually perform well in water. The High Court, you know, just to cut to the chase, at the end of the day, there was so much outcry by this that the High Court in France has said, you know what, maybe this ban's not such a good idea. We're going to suspend it, and we're going to continue to work on it. But in between, the law in Nice states... Access to public beaches is forbidden to any person not properly dressed, respectful of morality and secularism, respecting the rules of hygiene and safety. That is about as vague as you can get. It's super vague, and super vague things that then have legal consequences are bad, folks. So the fines are 38 euros, I think it was, up to 38 euros.
I'm not entirely sure.
It was £9 or 38 euros, I believe, is what I saw. So it's not a tremendous fine, but it's still a super annoying fine for going to the beach in a bathing suit, something that's designed to be at the beach. So there's several levels to this story.
It's the one that has layers.
Yeah, there's, well, it's not the only story tonight that has layers.
This is your parfait of awful, folks.
Yes. So there's, as you like to say, there's a lot to unpack here.
I need that shirt.
You do. We need to make that shirt. Okay. So, it's so insane, really. This is, again, a follow-on from the we discussed it earlier on the show, several shows ago, about the madman with the truck that mowed through, you know, the Riviera and killed a whole bunch of people, including Muslims.
Yeah.
Including including women in full hijabs.
The man was actually just
to
kill.
Not in hijabs, because hijabs are banned in France. Full face covering hijabs are completely banned in France. Did you know?
Yeah, no. France
is a little
France
crazy.
France has a very strained relationship with the Islamic faith. It goes back to them essentially controlling Algeria and that civil war and revolution. That's more history for you folks to dive down that rabbit hole of French imperialism.
Why have the bans been imposed? After a militant Islamist, you know, plowed a lorry into families on this. I like the BBC how they give these little sections of, you know, just the why and the what, you know, right at the end, like, Let's cover that right now, so in case you were curious. So, Nice on the 14th of July, 86 people. There are a number of cities along the French Riviera. I can't remember the number of them that's in the story here somewhere. I think it was confusing because I think it was like 14 different cities that stated they were going to ban, basically, Muslim dress. Any Islamic dress is essentially what they're shooting for.
It only affects the women.
It really does, yes, because Islamic dress codes only affect women.
It's mind-boggling. Yeah. Why are you... And these women aren't doing anything but wearing clothes. How is that hurting you?
Yeah.
How is that ruining your day?
Especially modesty. You know, because that's part of the dress and that's part of the law is to be, you know, properly clothed. You know, you're not. And along the French Riviera, are there not nude beaches?
Mm-hmm. Oh, there are nude beaches. It's just Europe.
Yeah, there are nude beaches. So it's like, wait a second. So being dressed is a problem? Being dressed is a problem.
These are the French.
Yeah.
So, I have to make the joke.
Okay, that's true. That's true. You need a baguette in your hand, a glass of wine, and you need to be naked.
You need to have sex after lunch, sex before lunch.
Yes.
And don't forget, you occasionally need just a smoke to take the edge off.
And you can certainly still smoke in public. But the bans are not just a response to the spate of the deadly jihadist attacks on French soil. France has long-standing laws on secularism, and the Nice ban focused on correct dress, respectful of accepted customs and secularism, as well as rules of hygiene and safety, or whatever that means. The French law says on secularism and religious clothing. Get this. Okay, so in 2010, France became the first European country to ban the full-face veil in public. Just outright. That was in 2010. And as we roll back the clock further, in 2004, a law forbids the wearing of religious emblems in schools and colleges. That includes, you know, just, you know, the little crucifix. You know, you can't wear that around your neck either. That's it. Full stop. And then all the way back to their constitution written in 1905 aims directly to separate church and state. It enshrines secularism in education, but also guarantees freedom of religion and freedom to exercise it. The original text made no reference to clothing. So if they go back to their constitution, you know, many of us here in the United States will say that's unconstitutional. You can't do that. You know, there you go. But there are also many of the local governors that say, no, I'm not going to listen to the court, like we've seen here in the United States. You know, activist judges, we can't have that. No, no, no. We know what's right. So they're going to maintain the ban anyway. So it gets more interesting. There's just a rash of interviews with people that this has affected just over and over. But the police got offended. Yeah. I know. Shocking, right? Sounds like something that would happen here in the United States again. The French official threatens to sue social media users who share burkini photos, specifically photos of the police harassing people wearing them.
How does that work?
A French politician has threatened to file a lawsuit against anyone who shares photos of or videos of police enforcing a ban on the burkinis, the full-body bathing suit designed for Muslim women. The statement comes after the widespread circulation, viral, you know, of photos showing a Muslim woman removing her clothes in front of four male police officers on a beach in Nice. Christian Estrosi, president of the Regional Council of Provence-Alpes-Côte d'Azur, I totally butchered that, congratulations me, and deputy mayor of Nice, said in a statement Wednesday that the photos, quote, provoke defamatory remarks and threats, end quote, against police agents. He added that legal complaints have already been filed to, quote, to prosecute those who spread the photographs of our municipal police officers and those uttering threats against them on social networks. So what we have here is the right to be forgotten.
Yeah.
He's trying to pull that one out, but for police.
Yeah. That is something that's going to be a sticky wicket in their court system.
Oh, yeah.
They are,
because the law itself is unconstitutional, the one that they were enforcing. And how do you find out about things that are wrong? You find whistleblowers. You find people that are spreading it. You draw attention to it. If you make that illegal, then there's no checks and balances on the system.
No, my opinion is, if you're a public official, sorry, you don't have that right. You want to have the right to be forgotten? Stop being a public official.
There is a I think, even within France's court system, where, again, right to privacy laws over there, an entirely different animal than over here, and much stronger.
Oh, yeah.
But if you are a public official, if you are a person of public standing, the right to privacy is not as extensive. Their protections. It is. I don't think there's anything on the books yet. How that applies to police. That is where precedent is probably going to be set within their court system over something as crazy and stupid as this.
I mean, that these are some really long and well-written articles. This is not the...
This is journalism.
This is actual journalism here. I mean, there's lots of cited references, lots of direct quotes, you know, lots of pictures and other cited sources. You know, it's well-done journalism here. And you can find all of those links on the show notes that'll be out on our website, ORLYRADIO.com. This is show, of course, 123, if you've forgotten. So you can go directly there and get all the good stuff and see for yourself and follow the rabbit down the hole and see where you end up.
I just need to say this.
Mm-hmm.
For all of our American listeners, think about this. A cop going up to a woman on the beach and forcing her to take off clothes.
Yeah.
That's what's going on here.
That's exactly what's
going on. Now put that into
your
American mind and watch it explode.
Oh, yeah. It's terribly absurd. So, yeah, here's a picture I'm showing on the YouTube stream of police just looking at the crowd, waiting to ticket people as they come out of the water.
That's insane.
It's like you either
waste of taxpayer money.
You either take it off, you leave,
pay the fine,
or you get the fine. And if you get the warning, then it's on your permanent record as well.
Yeah. Fine, boggling.
I mean, it's like broken window policing. Are they just trying to use it to trump up municipal revenue?
I don't even think it's that.
Yeah, I mean, it's not much, but
it's not enough for it to be bolstering. If it were like 100 euros, then yeah, that hey, we can buy that new ping pong table.
Well, there's a lot of Muslim women on the beach lately.
Yeah, but there's a difference between like, okay, every ticket's like that. What they're buying is pizzas, not ping pong tables.
There it is. A ruling could set a precedent for up to 30 other towns that impose bans on their beaches, ooh, chiefly on the Riviera. So at least three of the mayors have already said that they will keep the bans in their town.
Until it's constitutionally enforced, in which case, oh, look, all that government funding just goes.
Here's the town halls in Nice, Fréjus, and as well as in the Corsican village of Cisco. They have vowed to keep the bans in place.
And so, watch the government funding go away.
Yeah, well, yeah.
And then all of a sudden, those bans just kind of disappear.
And, of course, they're hiding behind the fear. This is the equivalent of think of the children.
Think of the children not looking at bare legs.
I know, yeah. In theory, this would be better. This is crazy. It's
don't
like,
think of the children looking at clothed women.
They're swimming. That
in clothes
usually isn't very good for bombs. It's not really good for firearms either.
No.
And they're not driving trucks while swimming.
No.
So, if there's anybody that does not pose a risk to you, is a woman in a burkini
on the Riviera.
On the Riviera, specifically in the water. If they're bathing in the Mediterranean, they're done.
It's targeting Muslims on the beach, on the Riviera.
Yeah.
Which is a haven and tourist attraction.
Yeah.
And they don't want Muslims mucking that up.
Yeah.
But again, I want everybody who's out there that is prejudiced against Muslims, just change the word to Jew.
Oh, yeah.
And see how comfortable you feel.
Does it feel anti-Semitic?
You feel.
It feels a little anti-Semitic to me. You know, that might be a little anti-Semitic. So, yeah. So I love when the police get offended by things like that. So.
Oh, let me get ready to press my outrage button.
Let me skip down one though. Because we don't want to hit that just yet. So first, since I was mentioning that you can't, you know, hide a weapon in a burkini, where would you hide a crossbow? Because in Canada,
that is a question.
In Canada, Canada, a guy went on a little killing spree with a crossbow in Toronto. With a crossbow.
Well, it is Toronto.
I don't know exactly what that means about Toronto, but yeah, in Toronto.
It's in, if I remember correctly, Toronto's in Quebec, and Quebec is the strangest part of Canada. It is the land of the strange.
If you say so.
Quebec is essentially their Florida.
Okay. Well,
they have crazy people who, if you do not speak French to them, will all of a sudden try and tear your head off.
Toronto is actually in Ontario.
Ah,
my. Okay.
It's Montreal.
Yeah, well, Montreal is in Quebec.
Yeah. So three people have died after an attack involving a crossbow in Toronto's East End, and police believe there is a link between the deadly incident and a suspicious package found in a downtown condo. The incident happened near Markham Road and Ellington Avenue, east of Scarborough. Thursday afternoon, should you be concerned. Toronto paramedics said two males and one female, all of them adults, were pronounced dead at the scene. Another person was taken to the hospital. The police source told Canadian TV News that at least two victims were hit by a crossbow bolt and that the incident happened in the rear garage of a house. The source said that two bodies were discovered in the garage and the third was found in the driveway. A man has been taken into custody, police said, and it doesn't appear that any suspects are outstanding. Thank you, Sprocket, for moving the entire screen. Podcat is on the scene. He is helping out as best as he can. Okay. Where was I? Oh, yes. Okay. Hi, Sprocket. Yes, there you go. Good boy. Hugs time. Okay. All right. A brief time later, a condo building near Toronto's waterfront was evacuated around 3 p.m. over concerns of a suspicious package. Detective Sergeant Mike Carbone told reporters Thursday afternoon that there is a link. Okay. Carbone said the downtown scene had been cleared, but would not elaborate on the connection. He also said the police are still in the process of contacting Scarborough's victim. So the community's in shock. It's very shocking, said somebody. Generally, it is a very quiet neighborhood. We're all happy to live here. Another resident says it's scary that the incident happened. Well, of course, yes, but, you know, it's still a crossbow. Questions remain about how exactly the incident unfolded, including how three people could possibly be killed by a crossbow. An archery expert who spoke with Canadian TV news channel on Thursday said it's, quote, an extremely long process to load a crossbow. Quote, this is quite the procedure. Even if you had a cocking aid, said Kathleen Millar, former technical and executive director of Archery Canada. You have to learn to lean over, pull it up. It's quite an onerous task. It takes quite a few seconds to get it set up in order to just cock it and then put the bolt on it. Milner pointed out that police are still unsure about the circumstances of the alleged attack, but said that she, quote, can't see that more than one person could have been injured that way. Quote, in a time frame such as that, the possibility of being able to recock a crossbow to use it again in a heightened situation like that, I find it very difficult to believe that it's possible.
Having so, fired a crossbow, my mother hunted with one at one point because she couldn't pull a regular bow.
Mm-hmm.
Two things. One, no. Lower-powered crossbows, very easy. Yeah, it takes a couple seconds. But that's just it. It's not that hard to cock and load.
It depends
extremely
on the
heavy-powered crossbows.
It depends on the size of the crossbow, which we do not know.
Yeah, I mean, if it's like a 35 or 45-pound crossbow, that's not a problem.
I mean,
that's easy. If it's like one of the big ones, like if you're dealing with something that's getting into like old school siege bow capacity, which you can get, which are, you know, 100 plus, approaching 200 pound pull strength.
Yeah.
The one with the windlass, which you have to wind.
Yeah, but it's the idea of but even modern day versions of that, one single bolt will go through one person and into another.
Yes.
It has that much force.
Especially since they're not wearing armor. At least there was no report that they were wearing armor in this case. But the thing is, I'm looking at this report. They are not showing pictures of the crossbow in question.
No.
But they did bring somebody in as an expert.
Well,
and
here's where things
and
get...
She would know whether or not that, you know, the differences between a single-hand crossbow, just a hand... like a pistol, and the big one that, you know, is shoulder mounted and, you know, and all that.
If I may interject, one of the individuals I follow on the YouTube, Skullagrim, one is a resident of Canada, and two, is somebody who likes, you know, weapons of antiquity. And is a bit of a proponent for gun rights up there in Canada. Canada's very restrictive on any form of weapon. They have very tight weapons regulations. So this entire story hinges really around the style of crossbow. Whether it was an antique, which is easier to get a license for, or it is a modern hunting weapon, or a recreation. Because regulations change, differing on those titles. How hard it is to have, what sort of license you must have, how much you had to pay for it.
I had a small pistol crossbow when I was 9. Yeah, I remember I had to, there was a little foot aid, you know, so I'd, you know, put my foot on it and then pull it up and to cock it, you know, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it could be done,
also,
certainly, yeah.
Within, you know, the 8 to 12 pound pulling capacity, I mean, there's recreations of the Chinese repeating crossbow that you can get your hands on. Which, in that case, you could be firing up to 12 bolts in a matter of a minute.
Right. The only thing is, I'm looking at it as the report, as listed for us, has an expert indicating that it would take a really long time to do it. So, I'm assuming, of course, that they may have some inside knowledge as to what kind of crossbow was used.
I will say, having just looked up Canada's laws, because my Google foo is strong.
Yes, it is.
Crossbows that are over 20 inches, basically over 500 millimeters, and require both hands to use are perfectly legal in Canada.
Huh.
So
under that, or single hand is the problem. That's where you need to get a license, or are straight out prohibited. But bigger than that, no, it's fine.
So it has to be a big one.
Most likely.
You know, almost 2 feet long.
It has to be a big one.
Yeah, okay. Probably. So there's some there's a story here, and I don't know what it is.
Unfortunate and slightly ridiculous story, but
yes,
a story.
All of that and more. But I just figured that, you know, with all the gun nut stories that we have here in the States, this one kind of stood out to me.
I'm waiting for this story to be used as a justification for why gun control doesn't work.
Exactly, which is why I wanted to bring it up. It's like, yes, well, there was that case of the guy that shot 3 people with a crossbow in Canada. Yeah,
if you want ridiculous stories of murder, okay.
Yeah.
I know of one story where a man murdered his wife with a frozen fish. Okay, I've no... of a homicide that was committed during the holidays with the murder weapon being a 9-pound candy cane. I know of a home defense that was against 2 armed burglars, well, in that case, robbers. When a man came home from his hunting trip, he disposed of both individuals who were armed with guns with his hunting bow. As distasteful as for me to say, clean kills, each taking 1 arrow to the throat.
Well, that'll do it. Now, how about any with anaphylactic shock?
There are definitely cases that have used whatever somebody is deathly allergic to murder the victim. Also, I think there was at least 3 separate episodes of Murder, She Wrote.
It might have been. It might have been. So I think we're going to see a bit more of that kind of thing here in the United States now. Possibly globally, because, you remember the
outrage button being pressed.
Remember the pharma douche,
Martin
Skrill, that guy. Yeah. Well, even
somebody
he
wants his crown.
Even he said this was shady. That's
the
bad.
Most hated man on the internet.
That's bad.
Said
yeah.
This was shady.
Yeah.
It's like that same thing of when the Nazis are saying, dude, you're going a bit
far.
Yeah,
it's like, whoa.
You might be going a bit far.
It's like, hey, now. So, yeah, so what are we talking about? We're talking about the company that produces the EpiPen, which is an epinephrine auto-injecting pen.
Mylan Pharmaceuticals.
The company that bought the rights to make the EpiPen.
Right. And, of course, all they have to do is make small changes to something anytime the patent is about to expire. Then they can re-up the patent. That way there's never a generic available. That's how they get away with this. So on August 17th, when this little thing broke out on NBC News, at least, EpiPen price hike has parents of kids with allergies scrambling ahead of school year.
Yep.
So, doctors and patients say that the Mylan Pharmaceutical Company has jacked up the price for an EpiPen, the portable devices that can stop a potentially life-threatening allergic reaction, from around $100 in 2008 to $500 and up today. That's a price hike of over 400%. Now, former pharmaceuticals executive Martin Skrill has weighed in, calling the Mylan company vultures.
Whew.
Right there. That's bad.
When Pharma Bro calls you a vulture.
Yeah.
You might be a vulture.
You might have gone too far. U.S. senators are...
This goes deeper.
Oh, this boy, deeper. Howdy does it. Yeah. So U.S. senators are scrutinizing the price hikes, one calling for an FTC probe. Connecticut Senator Richard Blumenthal, who pushed for emergency epinephrine to be stocked in public schools, pledged Friday to investigate the shocking increase. Quote, patients are calling and saying that they can't afford it, said Dr. Douglas McCone, an allergy specialist at Maplewood in Maplewood, Minnesota. Quote, they're between a rock and a hard place. Yeah, well, American medicine, your money or your life. Following a recall by Mylan's chief competitor last year, the company now enjoys a near monopoly. Because of aggressive marketing and branding campaigns and lobbying for legislation that requires the product to be stocked in schools, they have a brand dominance equal to that of Kleenex, doctors say. About the size of a fat marker, they are carried by many parents of kids with severe allergies wherever they go, ready to jam the gizmo into their child's thigh to deliver epinephrine to stop anaphylactic shock from a potentially fatal bee sting or a bit of peanut butter. And because they have stated expiration date of 1 year, parents refill them annually, incurring an additional copay each time. Tracy Bush, a 42-year-old mom and food allergy consultant, never goes anywhere without two EpiPens on her. Her son, age 14, carries another. She began doing so after he was diagnosed with severe allergies as a 2-year-old. For the past 10 years, she has watched the price she paid for her refills rise higher and higher with no discernible improvement to the device or medicine. In 2008, Bush said the price was $145.99. In 2010... to $20.99, then jumped to $649.99. This year, her pre-insurance cost were $1,118.08.
That's insane.
Despite the hikes, Bush was glad to have the two devices 2 years ago when her son had a bad reaction while eating some watermelon. Dude, watermelon. Bummer. That's terrible. Okay. The company, in a statement, Mylan said that the prices have changed over time to better reflect important product features and the value the product provides, your money or your life, and that we've made a significant investment to support the device over the past years. The company also offers coupons on its website that can reduce costs. This year, for the first time, Bush was able to use those coupons for her good insurance plan to bring down her out-of-pocket cost to zero, but not everyone can do the same. When epinephrine only costs a few cents, but they're going up to $500, personally, I don't think that's ethically responsible, said Dr. McComb. Yeah.
Also, this gets stickier.
It does.
When it comes to the coupons.
Here, let me move on to another thing here. Let's see.
Story?
There it is.
Yes!
Here we are. Let's go to that story. You can go ahead and read it, should you like. Oh, look. Partners in crime. They're like twins.
I will give the abbreviated version because I read this one.
Rock.
So, since the outrage, Myelin Envy, which is it's the company, CEO Heather Bresch, keep that name in mind for later.
Heather Bresch.
Well, they did what the pharma bro did, Shkreli, the most hated man on the internet, but maybe not for long.
You mess with kids' lives, you know, it's going to be a problem.
when Turing Pharmaceuticals, the company that he formerly headed, they used it, Daraprim, and drove its costs up. To discount the price, they didn't lower the price, they offered coupons. Which is exactly what they're doing. The Ori did a previous coupon program after they jacked up the price about 300% earlier, where you got a $200 coupon, but you had to properly file paperwork to get said coupon.
Of course.
Now they're offering a $500 or $600 coupon instead of actually lowering the price. And go find the lovely lady on a number of shows trying to do spin control. Going that no, we can't lower the price because of there are insurance companies involved and there's managers involved. So it would be irresponsible.
She defended the price hikes. Since acquiring EpiPens from generic drug maker Merck, saying the German company was spending virtually nothing to market the drug. So now we're just paying marketing costs. There's no marked improvement on it.
And here's another thing when it comes to the marketing costs, where I have to, I'm crossing over the threshold. I have to call bullshit.
Go ahead.
Which is, we heard earlier in a previous article that due to drug recalls, they have Kleenex-level influence on the market. You don't need to market it.
No.
It markets itself.
It is a required product,
Merck wasn't marketing because they didn't need to. This is a life-saving drug.
Yeah.
You don't need to market something that saves lives.
Yeah, you don't. Doctors already know about it. It's been on the market for years. They are ubiquitous. We see them in TV shows. This happens. You know, we already know about them. Now, it gets a little more interesting.
Yep.
So Bresch, she also ended up getting quite the raise. She went from 2 million a year to 16 million a year.
That's CEO compensation, folks.
Huge.
Also, she just happens to be the daughter of a U.S. senator.
U.S. senator.
Democratic one.
Joe Manchin from Democrat West Virginia. Yeah. Yeah, he is desperately trying to distance himself from his kin. Thankfully, he is not on the judicial committee, so he would have to recuse himself anyway. So, yeah, it's a bit ridiculous. Can't.
And this stinks of corruption.
What's this? Greed. He apparently has responded to his daughter's company jacking up EpiPen prices. We'll look at that in a minute. But there's other, you know, just you can follow this down just crazy holes. So Myelin was definitely behind trying to, you know, push the legislation to get them mandatory in U.S. schools. They said that they spent over like a couple years, like $700,000 in putting them putting two in schools. If the school needed more than that, they'd have to pay.
That's a drop the bucket when you're paying your CEO $16 million a year.
Let's see. It's around here somewhere.
And isn't the drug itself cheap to produce?
It's a dollar.
It costs a dollar to produce.
Cents, yeah. Now, the actual auto-injector pen, that's, okay. 15? Maybe $15?
I'm going to even be generous.
I'll say wholesale, maybe 20. 20 for the whole thing.
No, I'm going to be very generous and say that for full kit and caboodle in making the item, it costs $50. The entire thing.
Okay, that is being generous.
There is no conscionable reason to have these life-saving drugs cost more than $100.
No, they come in two packs. Used to be $300 for a set of two. Now it's, much more. Let's see. In Canada, where pharmaceutical prices are subject to regulation by the Patent Medicine Prices Review Board, EpiPen sells for just over $100 per device. Yep. Isn't that fun? I think that's fun.
It's called having a single market. The market gets to make the requirements of the people who are going to participate in that market. That's why you drive prices down. That's why the military have contractors trying to climb over each other hand over fist to get a government contract. Mm-hmm. Now think about having that buying power for us, for our health.
Yeah. Now, there's multiple links here. Some of just the names are crazy here, okay? Just the headlines for the links. Link-baity goodness here. Mylan CEO Heather Bresch goes down in flames defending her $16 million pay raise and EpiPen price hike.
EpiPen CEO, that one's hilarious.
Yeah, EpiPen CEO awarded MBA with grades pulled out of thin air because of her powerful connections. Senator Manchin finally responds to his daughter. EpiPen maker stock value plunges nearly $3 billion in investor panic.
Yep.
It did not go well. Did not go well. Yeah, it's a bit insane. Let's see. My browser is starting to. Well, you know what? They have too many Flash and Shockwave crap on their websites.
Yeah.
So things are getting unstable. Actually, I just better close all these tabs. Hang on, I'm just closing tabs. Lots of tabs. Too many tabs. Tabs! Because we've been through a lot of stories already.
Yeah, no. But
there we go.
I am just astounded by all this. You know how you do well in this day and age where you have the internet? Be a philanthropist. You want to do well in the pharmaceuticals? Be a philanthropist right now.
Read this headline.
Be the good guy.
Read this headline.
Revealed, American taxpayers funded 100% of research used to develop Big Pharma's EpiPen. We paid for this.
According to U.S. Uncut, the Pentagon approached the device's inventor, Sheldon Kaplan, in 1973 to enlist his help in developing a way for soldiers to administer a nerve gas antidote. Before being made available to consumers as the EpiPen, Kaplan's device was known as the Combo Pen. However, members of his family told the Tampa Bay Times that Kaplan never made royalties off his creation since he left the company where he developed it, Survival Technology, before it hit the market. So, there's no research and development cost associated with this. Not even by Merck.
Huh.
Yeah.
So, it's this still the same technology?
It's the same technology. It may have been updated with maybe a different injector compound or something, maybe, but it's basically the same thing. It is an auto-injector.
Also, 9 years ago, the single device sold for $47.
So about the 50.
Single pen 9 years ago. Yeah. Price hike of the device from $47 for a single pen 9 years ago to the current price of $284. And then, of course, with the latest, it goes even higher than that. Yeah. So there's going to be a nice Senate investigation, just like what Skrill had to go through because of this insanity. Now it gets, before we move right along, it's better. Gets even better. Because now, because it's so expensive, what do you have people doing? Doing it themselves. Going back to the old way of giant syringes with epinephrine in them.
Oh, good guys.
Yeah. So, that's fun. So, some regular families and many emergency medical responders are turning to manual syringes as a cheaper alternative. It's raising concern among some doctors and patient advocates who warn that it's more complicated to get the correct dose and administer it safely with the syringe. Quote, anyone using this approach would require extensive medical training to do it effectively and safely without contamination or accidental intravenous injection, said Dr. James Baker Jr., the CEO and chief medical officer for Food Allergy Research and Education. The organization's corporate sponsors include Mylan, which manufactures the EpiPen, and Sanofil, which used to sell a competitor. Amy Viet de Montbel. Wow, that's a great name. I'm just going to say that right now. That is a great name. Anyway, she felt that she didn't have a choice but to try the syringe. Her 12-year-old son is so allergic to milk that he wears a mask when he goes out in public. Last month, when she filled his prescription for the two-pack of EpiPens, one to take to camp and one for home, the cash register rang up a charge of $1,212. That's crazy.
She doesn't even pay that much for her mortgage.
Yep. She has health insurance with a $4,000 deductible, so she would have to pay the whole sum out of pocket. She didn't buy the EpiPens. At the doctor's office the next day, a nurse told her, sorry, your name, I'm not going to pronounce again, something that she had never heard before. For about $20, she could buy a couple of glass ampules of epinephrine and regular syringes from a local pharmacy and get the syringes filled with epinephrine at the doctor's office. They would expire in about 3 months, whereas EpiPens last about a year, but they could save her more than $1,000. She plans to get the syringes soon. Meanwhile, her older son, age 15, is carrying expired EpiPens because I can't afford to get him new ones right now.
I'm just thinking there could be an entire market about decorative syringe cases now for epinephrine syringes.
Oh, like cigar cases.
Yeah.
Beautiful cigar cases. I think you might have something there.
But you have to make sure that it's affordable because, well, with everything else, it's just too damn expensive.
You know what? I was so incorrect. There is no like injection gas or injection medium. It's spring-loaded.
Mm-hmm.
How expensive is a spring, people? Spring-loaded syringes filled with epinephrine.
And they are only meant to last for a year.
That is when they expire. Now, really, the expiration, it doesn't actually expire. Now, I'm not a doctor, so do not take this as to heart. But what it does is it diminishes in effectiveness as it continues to degrade. It will probably still work for many months after it has, quote, expired. And in an emergency, you better damn well believe that people are going to use it. So, because again, your money or your life. That's just the way it is with medical care in this country. I can't even.
And I know I'm probably asking a question of the choir, but do you honestly think that in a Trump presidency and a Republican House or Senate, they're going to regulate this? Let's, you honestly think that?
Let's talk about Trump. I like what you did there. That's a fantastic segue, because in Colorado, in his campaign office, it is currently being run by a 12-year-old boy.
He's probably doing a great job.
His name is Weston Immer. I don't even know what to really think about this.
I'm just upset that, you know, 12-year-old's doing a better job than me at getting into politics. I'm done. I'm just...
Well, he's...
Well, when you can pay him in you know, Lunchables...
I don't know. It'd have to be a volunteer position because...
Yeah. Child labor laws.
Child labor laws, yeah.
No. So he'd have to be volunteer.
Yeah.
There you go, Steve. You're asking too much. You're asking to get it paid.
Yeah, that's true. Pretty much it. So
and
hang
you
on,
don't
it's,
have
it's
the most important thing about being a paid member of the Trump campaign. You don't have the right last name.
Yeah, they probably have to be Trump. So
technically, his mother is the official field coordinator.
Technically, here's the boy. Oh. See if it plays.
I'm sorry. I look at that picture, and all I can think of is Draco Malfoy.
In nice. One of the
may
most
not
important
be wrong.
Elections of our lifetime.
My father shall hear of this.
Okay.
In one of the most important counties in the state, the Donald Trump campaign is relying on 12-year-old Weston Immer.
I am the co-chair for the Jefferson County Trump campaign.
We found him Friday putting the final touches on the Jefferson County field office, opening tomorrow in Wheat Ridge, the place where volunteers will gather to get out the vote.
Last year at school, kids would bully me.
Weston admits sitting behind the big desk may not always be the coolest thing to do, but he loves it now and hopes to inspire others.
Get involved. That's what I'm going to say. Just get involved. Kids need to be educated.
Of course, on paper, his mom is the official field coordinator, but she hopes giving her son so much responsibility teaches other parents, Democrat or Republican.
You have a responsibility to your children to teach them.
Weston is hoping to continue his role until school starts in September. Recruiting friends, making the boss proud, and maybe launching a career.
Do you want to be president of the United States one day?
Definitely. 2040. Watch for me. 2040. Imer and Imer and Barron Trump, if you're watching. In 2040, I'll take you as my running mate.
So there's that.
It sounded like I couldn't hear any of that. I was just watching Dan's facial reactions, and it was amazing.
I'm sorry you guys couldn't hear it, but it will at least... It went over to the podcast, so everyone will have that at least. But yeah, it's crazy. The kid is already working on a comb over. Nice, Mama Van. Nice. Glad to have you still with us. So yeah, in 2040, that little kid's gonna have a political career. The young Republicans. Unless,
if there's still a Republican Party left.
Unless he...
There will be.
Somehow, you know, because I was a Republican when I was his age because my parents were Republicans. So I you know, fed off that kind of politics, and that's what I knew. And as I grew older and experienced life and became a parent and things where life had to, you know, be more responsible, I realized that that was crazy. That was not a good idea. For me, you know, maybe it's different for you out there in Netlandia. I'm surprised you're still listening to the show if that's the case. But hey, you know, who knows? So, 12-year-old running the office.
Again, volunteer.
Yeah. Volunteer.
You don't have to pay them. And no. We know Trump campaign has one thing that they hate more, even the Mexicans. That's paying people.
That's true.
I'm impressed that Trump is able in Colorado to essentially organize, as certain people in the comment section are saying, the Trump youth.
Oh, no. Oh, I see what they did there, and I see what you did there. Oh,
do you
my.
See
oh.
the kids? I mean, let's be honest. He's a white kid with blonde hair, and I don't know what his eye colors are. I can't quite see.
Yeah, there may be a little Aryan in there somewhere, perhaps a little bit of that. What was his name again? It was Eimer is his last name.
Weston Eimer.
Weston Eimer. It's a little German. It's a little German.
But
okay, that's too much. That's too much. We're going off the rails with that. That's too much.
Yeah.
Goodbye, Weston. Good luck.
Supporters. Have you seen the groups?
They are white. Good heavens, are they white?
Super white.
Beyond that, some of them are straight out the Aryan Nation.
Yeah. Okay. Well, gentlemen, it is time for a true palate cleanser. Let's have some science.
It's the fruit plate, folks.
If you wish to make an apple pie from scratch, you must first invent the universe.
If you're scientifically literate, the world looks very different to you. It's not just a lot of mysterious things happening. There's a lot we understand out there. And that understanding empowers you.
If you base medicine on science, you cure people. If you base the design of planes on science, they fly. If you base the design of rockets on science, they reach the moon. It works, bitches.
Okay.
Again, couldn't hear anything. I was just watching your mouth move, Andy, and it was hilarious. I'm going, where are the words? Can I read it?
I did that for you. Yeah. I did that for you, yeah, since you weren't able to hear it, so I figured I'd mouth it. Okay, so, latest SpaceX Dragon capsule has returned just today? I think it was today, yes, with 3,000 pounds of cargo. You know, a lot of that just garbage, because, you know, you can't just space it up there. After delivering what is really a preparatory step for commercial crew delivery to the ISS. Now, I say that because of what they put out on Facebook. Today, Dragon returned home after more than a month's stay at the International Space Station. Its mission to the space station delivered about 5,000 pounds of critical science and cargo for NASA, including an international docking adapter that will enable U.S. commercial vehicles carrying astronauts to dock with the ISS.
Well, now.
Mm-hmm. So they are well underway to get prepared for a 2017 crewed Falcon Dragon capsule.
Well, beyond that, they're looking to the near future where they're planning on selling the ISS.
That is one of the next stories. Let's see, where is that? Yes, that's actually the last one that I was going to speak about. But yes, let's jump right to that. NASA hopes to sell the International Space Station. Live in office space for sale. 6 beds, 2 baths, over 32,000 cubic feet. Cubic feet, not square feet. Beautiful sunrises every 90 minutes. Convenient 23-minute plummet to Earth. Don't open the windows. NASA's operation of the International Space Station is scheduled to end in 2024. Now officials say instead of letting it fall out of orbit, they're looking to pass the outpost on to someone with the resources to keep it running. Quote, ultimately, our desire is to hand the space station over to either a commercial entity or some other commercial capability so that research can continue in low Earth orbit. And that was a statement by NASA's Bill Hill.
I'm honestly waiting just for Elon Musk to buy the thing, just straight out.
I think that the only way that that is going to happen, it would be as a low... as a way station, basically, for missions to Mars and the Moon.
Or the beginning of the construction habitat for the Tesla Model Space.
The Tesla Space Rover?
Well, think about all the different testing that he can do in low orbit.
The Tesla Lander. Yeah.
There we go.
But, no, for doing... for supply trips to the moon. Because you could have an easier time of launching stuff from the moon than you do from Earth. You're pulling against less gravity.
It's all about the gravity well, yeah.
And so using the ISS as a staging area, to build essentially a moon base.
Yep.
And the national docking means then anybody can dock with it. So
yeah, that basically it's a universal component. So as opposed to whatever the Soyuz capsule was using before that, you know, this is going to be something slightly different and good for people to go through. And of course, something geared and designed probably very heavily with SpaceX in mind. So companies like SpaceX and Boeing already run the commercial missions to resupply the station, and they'll start carrying crew in 2017. They seem well-positioned to take advantage, even if it's not clear yet what the private companies would do with their own orbiting lab. In the meantime, other space firms are invested enough that they want to improve the existing station. NanoRacks wants to add a private airlock to the ISS to launch its tiny satellites called CubeSats. That's the kind of science NASA wants to see. It said it before, the ISS presents unique research opportunities that could help pave the way for more commercial activity in orbit around Earth. Now, there were also, I don't have any stories on it, but, you know, this is just from my brain space. There was a lot of talks about capturing asteroids and bringing them into geosynchronous orbit. And then mining them there.
Actually, it still surrounds planetary resources.
Yeah.
That's the company. Planetary resources.
That's the company.
I follow it because also, who is it? Bill Nye is one of the main guys there.
Bill. Bill Nye, the science guy. Well, no, he's not part of planetary resources. He's part of the Planetary Society. He's the CEO of the Planetary Society.
No, he's also on this.
Oh, he might be a board member, yeah. But as far as his day job, he is the CEO of the Planetary Society. Now, also, NASA had a little bit of a surprise.
Oh, yes. But this is cool.
They were working very hard for 22 months to regain control over one of our solar observatory satellites, the Stereo B. Somewhere on the other side of the sun, almost directly opposite Earth, a 9-year-old NASA spacecraft, Stereo B, has drifted through the void of space since October 1st, 2014, unable to establish contact with our planet. At least that was the depressing situation until Sunday night. In a statement posted Monday, this is like last week's news. In a statement posted Monday, the space agency says it has finally contacted Stereo B Solar Observatory, an identical twin of another sun monitoring robot called Stereo A, after nearly 2 years of effort. The spacecraft was about 189 million miles from Earth when NASA finally made contact. Each Stereo spacecraft, named A for ahead and B for behind, launched in 2006 and began circling the sun in slightly different yet Earth-like orbits. That way, scientists could watch our backyard star and its angry eruptions from all angles. This also allowed NASA to get amazing 3D views of solar flares, huge loops of plasma, coronal mass ejections, and more. Though the $550 million mission was supposed to wrap up in 2008, it was a big success, so NASA just kept on going. Because, let's be honest, the guys at JPL that build most of this stuff do a really good job.
If they can get into orbit, it's likely to last.
It is overbuilt, which is how something like this, oh, it was down for 22 months, it's back up now. You know, and nobody went out to service the darn thing, so they managed to get it up. The trouble didn't hit until October 2014 when Stereo B went into a hard reset and lost touch with Earth. NASA tried to use the Deep Space Network to regain contact over the course of 22 months, finally succeeded August 21st. But Joe Gurman, a Stereo project scientist, said everyone involved in the mission is still sitting on the edges of their seat. The very hard and scary work is just beginning, Grumman told Business Insider. This spacecraft was designed to be autonomous as possible when it ran into trouble. If we turn on the computer, which is the only way we can get insight into what's going wrong with the spacecraft, what got us into this mess in the first place could turn back on again. So, as NASA detailed in a December 2015 article about the recovery effort. The spacecraft doesn't know if it's rotating or how fast. That's a big problem for a robot that needs to aim its solar panels at the sun and continuously charge its batteries, meaning it has barely been charging itself since it reset and could quickly drain the juice that is slowly built up. We have something like 2 minutes between the Stereo B receives the command to boot and one of its computers and when it starts doing what we don't want it to do. So this is one of those things where the speed of light matters, because it takes, I think it is 8 seconds.
No, I like the next paragraph says it great and I love it.
Okay.
Making matters worse, it takes about 20 seconds to send commands to the spacecraft and at a data rate that makes a dial-up modem seem lightning fast.
Oh yeah, yeah, because they're on the other side of the sun. So light from the edge, the coronal edge of the sun, takes 8 seconds to reach Earth. So 8 seconds on the other side, so there's 16 seconds. So that's how big the sun is. For light to travel from one edge of the sun to the other edge of the sun is 4 seconds.
Okay, that kind of hurt me somewhere. Yeah. I don't know where.
Yeah,
remember,
like,
that realization hurt.
It's like, oh, look, remember, math.
Remember, it's not a straight line. It has to go circle around it.
Well, no, that would be straight through. That would be
for the 20 seconds.
Well, it's going, you know, on edge. So basically, there's a cone with the sun in the middle, because otherwise we have to have line of sight. Otherwise, we can't get anything from them.
A signal.
Yeah. So that's where they are. As long as they don't speed up or slow down, that's where they're going to be. And then, so yeah, so we get 20 seconds direct from there, roughly in orbit. So yeah. So, give or take a little bit, it takes that long for light to travel from, if it was. That's how big the sun is. Just, yeah, straight line. Woohoo! That is crazy. Space is big. Space is really, really, really phenomenally big. You just don't have any idea how big space is.
No.
I, of course, butchered that quote from Douglas Adams, but, you know, that's the thing. So we'll keep looking at good old Stereo B, because some of the really cool stuff that happens on the sun is really dangerous to us. We kind of need to know about what's going on. So we've been mapping the sun and seeing its condition for a long time and getting that. Let's see. So it was supposed to wrap up in 2008, launched in 2006. So we've had 8 years of uninterrupted 3D modeling of the sun. That's pretty good. Of course, it's such a large object.
6 years above what was it was designed for.
Yeah. It's such a big object, though, that, you know, things could run on really long cycles. And we've seen some of those cycles go, and we wouldn't have if they didn't build such a robust system. So
good science takes time.
Exactly. Good science does take time. So, yeah, it's a long way out there. All the way on the other side of the sun.
In a similar to Earth orbit all around it.
Yeah.
Just on the opposite side.
Yep.
Which unfortunately tells us all that Gore is not in fact there.
Yeah, that's true. We can actually look on the other side of the sun. So, you know, this is perfect. So for any of you that encounter people that are conspiracy theory minded, you know, you can tell them, you know, look, we've got pictures. We've got animated, you know, movies of what the sun looks like in three dimensions. You know, it's not the whole flat Earth thing. Science works. Look at this. Of course, it doesn't really matter. They're not going to listen. Guess.
No.
Yeah, but.
But we can still try. I can dream. That's what we do.
I can dream, I guess. So let's see. I think that's it.
No, there's the IFL science thing.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, this is the more important thing.
Bum.
This is the really big chunk of cantaloupe.
bum, bum.
This is delicious.
NASA has made all of its research available online for free. For free. Ta-da! Just take it. It's here. Geeks and wannabe astronauts, rejoice. NASA has announced they're making all of their research publicly available and on a new online portable. The new site, PubSpace, will put up any research or data that NASA has funded within 1 year of publication. That's good enough. That also includes any peer-reviewed scholarly journals and papers, which are often barred by paywalls. So even that stuff will be available.
This is so delightful.
It's so wonderful. At NASA, we are celebrating this opportunity to extend access to our extensive portfolio of scientific and technical publications, NASA Deputy Administrator Deva Newman said in a press release. Through open access and innovation, we invite the global community to join us in exploring Earth, air, and space. The pledge is in the light of the government request to make science agencies more transparent and accessible. NASA hopes this increased public access accelerates the speed of information, fosters interest, and ultimately advances scientific knowledge.
And once again, going to the PMC and looking at the stuff, I love the names of the papers and the articles. Things like, first thing that popped up, synthetic biology meets bioprinting, enabling technologies for humans on Mars and Earth.
Sweet.
Zero temperature quantum annealing bottlenecks in the spin glass phase.
Oh, I knew
one
about
going
that.
Also different. The influence of sex and season on conspecific spatial overlap in a large, actively foraging colubrid snake. I have no idea what that's about, but I'm kind of interested just by the time. That's scientific clickbait right there.
So, also, snakes having sex in space.
Or probably.
Sex of the snake affecting how they exist in space.
I liked my answer better.
It's the more entertaining one. But for all of you science fiction fans out there,
yeah,
and novice science fiction authors, this is the stuff that dreams are made of. You have now a treasure trove of scientific jargon and understanding at your fingertips.
Remember,
this is how you do proper technobabble.
Yeah, remember, Andy Weir was just a space enthusiast. He didn't actually have any contacts at JPL or NASA when he wrote The Martian. He did it all on his own. He did it online. He open-sourced basically the writing of the book. And he had people critique his math, and he had corrections done, you know, as an ongoing project. And then eventually it was done. And then the people at JPL and NASA were like, how do you know all that?
Here we go. For those of us who
did really good, how'd you know that?
Those who have hair, who are interested in hair, effects of a closed space environment on gene expression in hair follicles of astronauts in the International Space Station.
You're not going to get that anywhere else. You're just not going to get that research anywhere else. except maybe for the European Union, because they recently said that they will also make all of their scientific research free and accessible by 2020. So we got a few years.
This is also, again, politics plays into everything. Politics affects your life, even if you don't think it does. Because in NASA putting all this forward, it puts international pressure on all of those who participate in scientific research in space to now make their research public.
Ooh. This is going to be one of those things that you fall into like Wikipedia.
Yeah. You just go in
deeper.
And you just start reading and it just doesn't
This is
stop.
Cracked articles, but for nerds.
So,
true.
Okay, filters activated. Published in the last 10 years. Huh.
Clear all to show 66 items. What?
Let's go last. Let's see here. 651 items. Let's go all the way to the last one, the earliest one in here. From 2006, prebiotic materials from on and off the early Earth.
Sounds so interesting, that. That's actually compelling.
That is. Global temperature change from 2006.
Huh.
Abstract, global surface temperature has increased approximately 0.2 degrees Celsius per decade in the past 30 years, similar to the warming rate predicted in the 1980s in initial global climate change simulations. The transient green. Well, there you go. So all the climate change documents, too, they're going to get out here.
Yeah.
You want to do your own research? Go ahead. We can give you the exact scientific paper. Here you go.
The from 2015, ethyl alcohol and sugar in comets.
In comets?
Yeah. There were some that were alcohol comets.
Cool.
That were coming through. I seem to remember talking
the
about
booze
those.
Booze comets.
Yeah, pretty much. It was like vodka or something. You know, basically.
Bring me the vodka comet.
Lower body negative pressure treadmill exercise as a countermeasure for bed rest induced bone loss in female identical twins.
I don't know why that's a study, but I'm glad it's there.
Organic haze on Titan and the early Earth.
That's compelling.
Red tides in the Gulf of Mexico. Where, when, and why?
See, I thought this was going to be far more sterile.
This is good stuff.
This is good stuff.
A core transcriptional network for early mesoderm development in Drosophila melanogaster.
Again, beyond anything else, just how it's written. This is cool.
Mm-hmm. Developing global climate anomalies suggest potential disease risks for 2006 to 2007.
Don't say.
Huh. Wow. Technology for cell cycle research with unstressed steady-state cultures. Oh, man. There's stuff in here for everybody. Some
simulating
really
social ecological systems, the Island Digital Ecosystem Avatars Consortium.
Oh, wait a second. So this is...
That sounds like something you'd find in Shadowrun.
This is not just NASA. NASA has published all of their findings to PubMed.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the U.S. National Library of Medicine, National Institutes of Health publication site. Now, the things that we're looking at, though, NASA funded is the filter at the top. Oh, these are my geek laughs. These are my angry nerd powers. You know, they're all.
These are the all, Andy all, is not going to be getting sleep for the next 2 weeks. Laugh.
They're all.
But also, for all of you out there who want to know why we need NASA, you have evidence here.
Yep. NASA does a lot of Earth science. We need the Earth science too.
But also keep in mind, from what our friend Dr. Tyson says, when it comes to your tax dollar, NASA doesn't even get a penny.
Yeah.
Not a full penny.
Fractions.
Of your tax dollar. Fractions of a penny. Go into
And yet, the investment
this.
In NASA... has shown to have leaps and bounds of payout.
Yeah, for every dollar, it's like seven that returns out. You know, and that's being very ultra conservative.
Again, I wish that in my taxes, I could go, hey, could you please? I'll pay a little more if it goes to this. This here, I want to fund this. This is important.
Stochastic and deterministic processes interact in the assembly of desert microbial communities on a global scale.
That sounds important.
Terrestrial planet formation. Establishing a molecular relationship between chondritic and cometary organic solids. The effects of simulated microgravity on expression profile of microRNA in human lymphoblastoid cells. This is some good stuff.
This is some really, stuff that can help you fight cancer. Okay, this is okay. Stuff that helps all forms of sciences, not just
absolutely.
Earth or space science, but also in the fields of medicine, in the fields of botany, mm-hmm. and biology. This is all important stuff.
I get a feeling when we come back from the break, we're going to be wishing we were just diving more into that section.
I think really we had so much to go through because the world is crazy, and those were some really super interesting stories. And you know, it's coming up at midnight. I don't know that we need to necessarily continue, but I want to hit these as quickly as possible, just to let people know that we're talking about them, and then we'll call it quits.
Forget the intermission. Just go.
We'll just call it. But we'll breeze through this because you know, obviously, we want to get back to the PubMed stuff and NASA because that's just more interesting reading than I've seen in a long time. So into Law and Order. Where's my sound drop? Oh yeah, there it is. Okay, there we go.
So, I heard that.
I don't understand this system. We're using Skype right now for our meeting, so we get some interesting audio artifacts in this way. So we'll try Hangouts again next week and see if that works better. It seemed to work better for those of us on the call, but yeah, we'll see if that continues. Though I will say that the XSplit broadcaster did have a update before I started today, and I said no. I do not wish to do that. So I'll work on that over this week. So anyway, in Law and Order, the Justice Department has been busy. We've got two.
Oh, yeah.
We got two items that we need to bring to everyone's attention. The Justice Department says that it will end the use of private prisons.
Now, this is just federal.
Just federal. But the Justice Department plans to end its use of private prisons after officials concluded the facilities are both less safe and less effective at providing correctional services than those run by the government. Deputy Attorney General Sally Yates announced the decision on Thursday. This is older news. We were going to talk about it last week. In a memo that instructs officials to either decline to renew the contracts for private prison operators when they expire or substantially reduce the contract scope. The goal, Yates wrote, is reducing and ultimately ending our use of privately operated prisons. Now, yeah, this is just federal. So the states still get to run their private prisons and do whatever they wish with that. But at this point, the Corrections Corporation of America, or whatever, I think, they're a publicly traded company. They went from like $47 a share to $13 a share overnight when this was announced.
I wish I had done a put option on that. Like, I would have made bank.
Oh, yeah. I mean, had you known, it's like, woof, some crazy stuff. I'm looking to see if that was... no, that's not going to be mentioned here. This is a very long, very detailed...
look, journalism.
Yeah, it's,
but the
it's
key,
a very
the key thing they
article.
Put in here that I see is the big reason why a lot of people... Why it was always... You know, you've heard it, I've heard it, people out there, listeners have heard it. The reason why, you know, they ever wanted to go to the private prisons was... A lot of the reasons why was because of cost. And yet this report shows... That in the, actually quoting from it, they simply do not provide the same level of correctional services, programs, and resources. They do not save substantially on costs.
Yeah,
and that was the main reason the drive to go for them is because oh look, it will cost less. No, it doesn't.
Exactly. So now state legislators can bring this the research that is already done and what the federal government has already done, the statements by the Department of Justice saying they don't work, we need to stop. And just bring that to the state government. The location and population of contract prisons. 8 states have federal contract prisons. Texas has the most with 5. The inmate population ranges between 1,000 and 3,200 at each prison site. There's 1 in California, 1 in New Mexico, 5 in Texas, 1 in Mississippi, 2 in Georgia, 1 in North Carolina, 1 in Ohio, and 1 in Pennsylvania. So I'm sure Corrections Corporation of America and GEO Group now run most of the 13 affected facilities. Those companies were the greatest beneficiaries of a 3-decade period when the government toughened sentencing for drug offenders and was unwilling to expand the federally run prison system in step with the exploding prisoner population. CCA and GEO convinced Washington that they could provide the alternative and both become increasingly reliant on the government for their business. I don't know why I decided to go a southern drawl on that, but boy, did it make sense. So
yeah, August 1st, their stock for CCA was at 32.54. August 18th, it was 17.57. In one day, it went from 27. It offs over $10 in one day.
Yeah.
Between the 17th and the 18th.
Again, corporations are only interested in making profit.
Yeah.
That's so if they can bill Uncle Sam, they will bill Uncle Sam for all he's worth.
And GEO was the same.
Yeah. Now, the U.S. Marshal Service and the Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency, they both also have deals with them. So it'll be interesting to see whether or not those deals are also affected by the Department of Justice, which I believe the U.S. Marshal Service is a sibling
part of the DOJ,
though. Aren't they?
Yeah, I think they're under the DOJ. ICE, I don't think is.
Oh, ICE, I know for a fact is not. ICE is under DHS.
Are they DHS or were they State Department?
ICE is DHS.
Okay, but before they weren't.
Before they were not. That's correct.
Yeah, because DHS came in and absorbed so many different sibling agencies.
Yeah, U.S. Marshals Service is part of the Department of Justice. It's part of DOJ.
Okay, so the U.S. Marshals Service will have to abide by that. So
yep,
that's,
and they will
that's
scale big. Back or yep. let contract run out.
Yep. Everything is subject to renegotiation.
Got it.
Which is so good. So good. So, and in other fairly good news, at least, it's potentially good news. It's certainly up for discussion. The Justice Department says that the poor can't be held when they can't afford bail.
Because, again, like what most people think, you know, guys, long time ago, like, very long time ago in this country, we got rid of debtors' prisons.
A long time ago, yeah.
Because
it was seen
happens.
As immoral.
Yeah.
It was also something that the English did.
That's true.
Back when we were still trying to differentiate what it meant to be an American citizen versus what it meant to be a part of the UK, this was one of the defining things. Because the UK, for the longest time, and a lot of the reason why we had this mass immigration to the US was to avoid debtors' prisons.
Holding defendants in jail because they can't afford to make bail is unconstitutional, the Justice Department said in a court filing late Thursday. The first time the government has taken such a position before a federal appeals court is the latest step by the Obama administration in encouraging state courts, mind you, to move away from the imposing fixed cash bail amounts and jailing those who can't pay.
And if I may, one of the few states that's actually progressive on this stance is Florida.
Oh.
We're actually good at something.
Wow, amazing. How'd that happen?
we have to get one right every now and again.
Yeah.
It actually happened because we had a number of private law firms that had a boatload of money and were looking for a really good PR nudge.
Bail practices that incarcerate indigent individuals before trial solely because of their inability to pay for their release violate the 14th Amendment. Just to be specific. on what they're talking about. The filing came in the case of Maurice Walker of Calhoun, Georgia. He was kept in jail for 6 nights after police arrested him for the misdemeanor offense of being a pedestrian under the influence. He was told he could not get out of jail unless he paid the fixed bail amount of $160. So
he was drunk in public.
He was, yeah, drunk and disorderly kind of thing. 6 nights in jail. So I wonder what it costs to have somebody in jail for 6 days. I bet it's more than $160.
Or close to it.
I think we lost money on that deal as a government.
Well, I think more people in the county lost money on that than us at the national level.
Well, no, I'm just speaking as the government as a whole.
Yeah, no, yeah. We lost money on that deal.
The royal we, if you will. Oh, wait, not royal. No, that's the wrong kind of government. Yeah, so this is interesting. It's very interesting, and I have not heard any politicians speak of it during this election cycle.
No, not this election cycle. Interesting thing is that stuff like this was being brought up, and part of the reason why Florida's kind of ahead on this was two Senate races beforehand.
Mm-hmm.
Is when this was actually something that was championed, at least here in state. Okay. Also in other states. And no, debtor's prison is, one, unconstitutional, and two, it's an immoral blight. It is the also, and here's where things get kind of sinister. Those who are subjected to prison because they cannot pay bail are more likely to take plea deals and plead guilty than actually pursue the course of justice and maintain their innocence.
Right, because how could they pay bail and afford an attorney?
Yeah.
In many cases, I mean, that's legal costs are big.
Forced to take the plea, and in doing so they become criminals. It makes it almost impossible to find work after the fact, even though that person may have been perfectly innocent of the crime that they were accused of. But they felt it was in their personal best interest at the time to just get out of prison as quickly as they could.
Yeah.
And they took the plea. And it ruined their life.
Oh, easily.
Completely ruined their life.
It's something else. It's really... I'm happy to see it. I'm happy to see any work done on that. So, the last story in Law and Order here, not including, of course, the ones that we talked about at the top of the show, but another big win, SCOTUS just banned domestic abusers from owning firearms.
Yes!
So it was a 6-2 Supreme Court decision. The crime of reckless domestic violence and abuse is now considered a misdemeanor that justifies...
I want to know who the two were.
That justifies firearm possession restriction. What does that mean? It means closing one of the many gaping loopholes in gun control legislation and cracking down on violent domestic crime. Most importantly, it means safer homes for those most at risk, women, especially women of color, LGBTQ, folks and children. Let's see. Does it say who said what? Let's see. Of course, the ladies on the court definitely went with this one. Not seeing who said what. Nope, I'm not seeing it.
Well, Kagan authored the
majority opinion.
Majority opinion.
Who wrote
this? Thomas filed a dissenting opinion.
Why am I not
surprised? And Woods Sotomayor joined as to parts 1 and 2.
Mm-hmm. Fun. Okay. Nice.
I mean, Kennedy went with the positive.
Kennedy with the majority. So we know Thomas was one of the two.
Sotomayor, I think, was the other one.
Oh.
Really? Huh. Okay, interesting. All right. So we don't want to get into it too much. There's, you know, as soon as we get into Supreme Court stuff,
I will start diving this, and I will not come out for a while.
And it becomes a bit mind-numbing. It's just one of those things that happens. So instead, let's talk about some good ideas.
It's time for another good idea, bad idea. Good idea.
Okay, so amazingly enough, all those Polish jokes happen to be wrong. Okay? Well, okay, maybe not all of them, but at least one of them, they can build an awesome bus. So they came out on top in a something I didn't know was a thing, a bus of the year competition. So whoa. Polish electric bus oust Mercedes to become the bus of the year for 2017. Apparently they do it kind of a year ahead, one of those things. So designed and produced in Poland, the Solaris Ubrano 12 electric bus has received the prestigious international title Bus of the Year. The decision was made by a jury of experts from 20 countries. The Polish electric bus with pantograph left machines. With a pantograph. Pantograph? What is a pantograph? I imagine that's not quite the right word. Of course, we're getting a translation from Polish. So it left machines from Mercedes. They presented a vehicle powered by compressed natural gas. And Ebusko, Evnar, and Van Hool, these producers put on electrical drive, left them all behind. The title was awarded for the year 2017.
To answer your question, If you've ever seen the electric buses or trams or anything else that have the giant cables above and they have things that touch them to transfer power, that's a pantograph.
Oh, okay. So it does have a ability to hit those. But it does also have a lot of batteries. The Solaris Ubrano 12 electric is equipped with batteries with a total capacity of 240 kilowatt hours. During the tests, the energy was replenished by an innovative charger boosting the capacity of 80 kilowatt. Developed by a big company in Poland, yeah. Polish supplier of customized charging stations for electrical vehicles and charging infrastructure management systems. Okay, so during the test, the bus was also charged using the pantograph. Thank you very much for the pantograph thing, because I've seen them before, and I have even, like, little model trains and things like that that have a pantograph on them. So it's like, oh, okay, now I know what
Google
that is.
My Google Foo is strong.
Yeah, and fast.
I must keep constantly using it.
And fast, absolutely, but, yeah.
No, this is fantastic for those countries that have designed their mass transit to be useful.
Exactly. Field tests for the vehicles were carried out in Brussels. Acceleration, braking distance, vibration, and noise levels, among others, were tested thoroughly. The general evaluation was also influenced by subjective impressions of the individual jurors. So, did they like it? Yeah, I liked it. A closer look was taken at the buses, not only from the driver's perspective, passengers and their comfort were also taken into consideration. Oh, that's nice. That's good. So, that's a good idea, is having some electric buses. Fully electric buses on the road. And also a nice thing, you know, for Poland.
Yeah.
Now, we talked about Japan at the top of the show losing billions from their coffers and their pension plan. But now, something a little bit different. Japan's military begins training for new overseas missions. This is interesting. Because I was unaware that they didn't already do this.
Well, again, all their missions before overseas have always been very typically, we're helping with supplies, we're helping with logistics. They do not send actual combat troops over.
But there's a reason for that. So,
which has now changed.
In a further shift in Japan's pacifist post-war security policy, it was a policy. The military has begun training to carry out new missions overseas. Defense Minister Tomoe Inoue announced the change for the self-defense forces is what they were referred to as, saying units would start training Thursday. Now, I have to agree. It's natural to, he says, it's natural to make the proper preparations to respond under any circumstances. Yeah, I gotta admit, that's completely true. So under revised security legislation that took effect earlier this year, self-defense force troops will train for a United States peacekeeping mission in the South Sudan starting in November. That will include troops potentially using weapons to rescue UN staff and joining troops from other nations in defending the barracks of peacekeepers if they come under fire. The law to expand the role of the military were revised after Prime Minister Shinzo Abe's cabinet
Abe.
Thank you. The cabinet reinterpreted the nation's pacifist constitution. Previously, Japanese peacekeepers could only use their weapons to defend themselves if attacked, and that was, quote, limited to the minimum necessary to protect the lives of personnel. A very pacifist stance in their reparations for World War II there. It does eventually allow Japan for the first time to come to the rescue for other nations, said Michael Chuk, an adjunct fellow at Temple University's Japan campus. Basically, until now, Japan was a lead weight on peacekeeping operations. So this is really an interesting move, something we hadn't seen for decades.
Mm-hmm.
But since we haven't seen it for decades, I'm not sure what to think about it.
It will allow them to take a bigger role in certain peacekeeping operations. I think partially, I like what they say. It's like, you know, they will be allowed to come to the rescue of other nations. That in, from a local standpoint, local politics, especially if they start doing that, like, you know, you have groups that are under fire at a forward base somewhere dealing with something, and suddenly, you know, Japanese helicopters of troops come in, lay down fire and pull, say, especially American troops or some other Western powers troops out, that will give a very big boost to just Japanese pride. And look at us, you know, we're, you know, again, still not the beaten people. We come back from everything. Even the great powers need us, and that kind of attitude, which I am honestly for. I don't want seeing them develop a full on frontline military like they had before and like we have.
Yeah,
but seeing them being able to do specialized roles like this, I think would be a much needed boost to their own personal national morale.
Well,
in those areas,
maybe, certainly to a faction, but each step, you know, stated here as the last line here, each step toward full militarization has been met with unease among ordinary Japanese.
Mm-hmm. So I don't ever think they should go full militarization. I agree with that. They should not go with that. They don't need to, unless North Korea keeps being stupid.
I really think we need them to go with their strengths. We need giant robots.
True.
So,
well, again, as,
I'm
as
fully in favor.
Said, they're really good at organizing peace.
I am really in favor of giant robot self-defense forces. I think that's what
they need
to
concentrate on. Robot fight coming up.
That's true. So, okay. And now we're into bad ideas.
Bad idea.
British companies... Yeah, yeah. British companies are selling advanced spy tech to authoritarian regimes.
Why am I not surprised?
I believe you were talking about the spy queen? I believe
yes.
That, I believe those
our,
were
our
words that came out of your
Prime
mouth.
Prime Minister, who pretty much wants to do everything she can to snoop on her citizens.
Well, apparently that technology is what's good for the goose is good for the gander. So some of the UK companies were given permission to export their products to authoritarian states such as Saudi Arabia, the UAE, Turkey, and Egypt, countries with poor human rights records that have been well documented to abuse surveillance technology.
Again, also the UK exports tons of military hardware, and it's not necessarily going to, you know, mom and pop countries, folks. It's going to the people who have demand for these goods. The people who have demand for these goods are not good folks.
And these goods are interception technology. including IMSI catchers, devices which can monitor large numbers of mobile phones over broad areas, telecommunication stuff. You know, the stuff that we were talking about earlier about locking down an entire country's internet. Yeah, that's the kind of stuff that Britain is selling to these authoritarian regimes.
And Turkey came up with this.
Yes. Yes. Do you see, I got this, an entire smorgasbord of just wonderful things for this show. So I kind of wanted to encapsulate it all, because it's like, oh, geez, they're all just segueing off each other so terribly. We are in a very interesting world. May you live in interesting times. It just keeps popping up in my head over and over again.
And just remember, everyone, interesting doesn't mean good.
It's a curse. I mean, really, come on.
It's a curse for a reason.
It's a curse, yeah. So, as we learn time and time again, countries with bad human rights records often keep utilizing interception technology to perpetrate even more abuses and suppress dissent.
It's more often that last part where this sort of tech gets used.
Yep. So the IMSI catchers, sometimes known as stingrays, which we've spoken about on the show before. That the NSA was using, and certain local law enforcement agencies, they were using
without warrant.
Right, completely without warrant, because, well, we're just listening. It doesn't matter, you know, or something along those lines. So they're basically fake cell phone towers, which force devices in their proximity to connect. In the data obtained by Motherboard, which is the website that we're looking at, 33 licenses are explicitly marked as being for IMSI catchers, including for export to Turkey and Indonesia. Indonesia has terrible human rights violations on record. Other listings heavily suggest the export of IMSI catchers too. One granted application to export to Iraq is for a wideband passive GSM monitoring system, which is a more technical description of what many IMSI catchers do. So, yeah. Isn't that fun? Isn't that fun? It makes me never want to travel the world, is what it does. Not that it's necessarily much better wherever you happen to be.
This is war profiteering.
Yeah. The following is a list of exporters within the scope of your request that have had export licenses granted or refused from the ECO. BAE Systems Applied Intelligence Limited, BN Security and Defense Solutions LTD, Celsion LTD, Cobham TCS Limited, Comstrack Limited, CRFS Limited, Domo Tactical Communications DTC Limited, Gamma TS, these are great names. Gamma TSE Limited, these are for your next Shadowrun campaign, guys. Horizon Technologies Consultants Limited, Mega Blue Technologies Limited, Prestige Security Management LTD, ProSolve International Limited, QCC Global Limited, and Seven Technologies Group Limited. Oh, wait, there's more. Smith Myers Communication, TGL Services UK Limited, and TRL Technology Limited. That list was companies provided by the Department for International Trade. Yeah. They withheld product descriptions of exactly what they were requesting to go out. Two temporary licenses are for DNA trackers, a product made by Mega Blue Technologies Limited. DNA trackers can not only track phones' location by their IMSI numbers, so it's not actually tracking people. That's okay. It's just tracking their phones. But also devices such as laptops too. Through their individual MAC addresses. Oh, geez, MAC addresses. Yeah. The data includes two successful license applications for temporary export of the product to China and Kuwait. The company's website suggests that the gear could be deployed on airports or for crowd monitoring and property protection.
So crowd control.
Yes.
And identifying of dissidents.
DNA Tracker has the capability to search for and find mobile phone operator mobile phones operating on systems provided by local network providers. DNA Tracker is a system that characterizes the local mobile phone environment, then uses the collected data to scan for mobile phones in the vicinity. DNA Tracker has the capability to scan and capture IMEI, IMSI, and other data pertinent to mobile phone identity. The system will date, time, and position stamp each handset as it is found, centrally stored, and managed. The system can also search for and track individual handsets, including known and unknown assets. It can be used to capture the identities of all handsets that are static or moving within the vicinity of a tracker unit or inside a geofenced area, which can be of any shape or size. Browser-style interfaces for is used for configuration and display of captured data, which can be either live or historic, and provides the capability for data mining. Each tracker unit features a GPS in order to fix the exact position of the equipment. Equipment can be rapidly deployed by non-expert personnel. DNA Tracker is designed to interface with existing systems, and its heat mapping and triangulation capability can be integrated into existing global information systems.
Yeah, China needed to have this.
China needed to have that. Kuwait needed to have that. Absolutely. Totally. Oh, man. And it just keeps getting better and better. There's so much here of just ugly, ugly stuff.
Corporations are amoral, folks.
Yeah. So there you go. There you go. Enjoy. Enjoy. So, yeah, that's definitely bad ideas. Oh, and speaking again of the UK, yeah, this is definitely the one to end the show on. Human Rights Act will be scrapped, the government confirms. I just want to see Dan's face. Just, you know.
I'm following this somewhat. Because there's like 20 different sides to this story.
Easily.
And I haven't been able to, from all the different sources that I've gotten, to see what's up and down. What we know is that the current Bill of Rights that is in place is going to be scrapped. Now, what we're hearing is for it to be a different quote unquote stronger bill to be put in its place, but there's this gray area where this can be stripped and then not something put immediately in its place, and that's where things get scary.
Well, the text of the article: the government has confirmed the Human Rights Act will be scrapped in order to separate the UK from the European courts, causing alarm among human rights organizations. Liz Truss, who is in the picture here, the newly appointed Justice Secretary and Lord Chancellor. I want a title like that. Lord Chancellor.
Be English.
Apparently. Revealed the news while dismissing concerns from some conservatives that the plan, a manifesto pledge in both 2010 and 2015, had been axed. Quote, "We are committed to that. That is a manifesto commitment," she told BBC Radio 4 Today program. A few details of the plan have been released, but the Ministry of Justice has said it, quote, "will set out our proposals for a Bill of Rights in due course," adding, "we will consult fully on our proposals." However, Prime Minister Theresa May reportedly ordered a view of the plans in the wake of the UK's decision to leave the European Union. Quote, "She is understood to be concerned about the proposals as they stand, particularly a concession agreed by the previous government that Britain would remain signed up to the European Court of Human Rights," the Daily Telegraph reports.
And if I'll interject here...
Oh, yeah, please.
This is part and parcel of what, in theory, the Brexit was going to allow them to have a sort of a la carte is what they wanted.
Yeah.
And that leaving the European Union, they wanted to renegotiate with the EU for just the bits they liked. The big thing that they liked is access to the single market, which allows a lot. You know that free trade thing that corporations love?
Yeah.
It's that, but every member of the EU has access to a singular market which trades with the entire EU at set rates.
Hmm.
So it's all good. You don't have to negotiate a rate with each member nation. Flat rate.
I imagine there's a lot of people that are burned over a flat rate pricing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But who cares about the little guy?
Oh, no, I'm not talking the little guy. I'm talking big guys that want to make more money. Like, you know, people that happen to spike the prices on EpiPens.
We're
talking corporations.
It goes both ways. Because some nations get toasted by it, Spain. While other nations, the corps are getting toasted by it, Germany.
Yeah.
So it just depends on how low or high on the totem pole you are. Now, there's one special case within the EU, which is Norway, which is not part of the EU. They left.
Mm-hmm.
But through special concessions and negotiations, they have limited access to the single market. Britain wants what Norway has, but they're not going to get it because of how they acted.
Well, Bella Sankey, the director of policy at civil rights campaign group Liberty, told The National, "Surely it can't have escaped the Lord Chancellor's attention that our country has seen a spike in hate and division in recent months. In the current climate, our new Justice Secretary should focus on providing unifying leadership, not pouring her energy and yet more public money into scrapping human rights and equality protections that are needed now more than ever."
Now, again, the Human Rights Act keeps them in line with the European courts.
Yeah.
It is part of
the Articles of the European Convention on Human Rights. The freedoms must be upheld by all public bodies, and British courts and tribunals must interpret legislation in a way that is compatible with the rights enshrined in the convention.
And part of the thing where the conservatives don't want this. The Tories don't want to be beholden to the European courts because one of the big things in order to get access to that single market and be a member of the EU is freedom of movement.
It's part of the 15 fundamental rights and freedoms.
Yeah, and it's the big one that the Tories hate. Because it means that, hi, are you a citizen of any nation within the EU? Are you a citizen? Mm-hmm. Recognized. You may be one of those people who have left a Middle Eastern country and become naturalized in a EU member nation. And then you, by laws and conventions of the European Union, you can then transit to any EU member nation and seek employment.
Yeah.
You don't have to necessarily reside there. You could be living over in, like, France and commute over to England to work.
Yeah.
And then take the shuttle back. Or you could take the ferry back from Norway. Or Sweden.
Yeah.
It's these sorts of things that the Tories are tearing their hair out about. And the European courts would crack down on them for leaving the EU. So they want to be free of the courts. They don't want to have their courts tied up by this legislation to not give them the rulings that they want by law.
They're also trying to avoid lifting the ban on prisoners' voting rights being returned, or and also banning whole life sentences for serious crimes, apparently. They want those to remain. At least that's how I'm reading that. So there's more to it, of course, than just that. There's a bunch of little line items. Like when we went through the GOP party platform, there's lots of little lip service to all sorts of different items.
Yeah, they want to put a stamp on what it means to be British. This is part of the Tory agenda.
A British Bill of Rights, rooted in British values.
Written
whatever
in,
that means.
We don't like them dirty foreigners' values.
yes. Don't you know that the East India Trading Company had to have them all under our thumb? We don't want them as citizens.
It's the Tories want very much what our Republicans want. They want a more white version of their nation.
I love how they say restore common sense. Common to them. As long as they're saying it, it's common, right? And tackle a misuse of the rights contained in the convention. Oh, they're not doing law right. No, no, no. Those rules don't mean for them. No, 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 no. That's for us. Oh, jeez.
And this is part of the sinister side of the Tories.
I love that this is highlighting so much that politics the world around, for as much as they smell different, or
there's
seem
different,
different
bits of culture,
yeah, they're still veneer, still rooted in human nature being terrible.
Again, the powerful want to gain more power and stay powerful.
Yeah.
They don't want to share power. That would diminish them.
That would diminish the power that they have. It's not about bringing other people up. It's about maintaining their superiority.
And enforcing it.
Yeah, you can't have equal rights with me because that would diminish the rights that I already have. By comparison. They want to maintain that lauded status. Which is the same thing we see here. Same thing. That's why they stand in the way of civil rights and equal rights and things like that. Because to them, instead of providing for others and giving that hand up to somebody, it then brings them at the equal footing, and then they have to work that much harder to get past them again. Because they're not allowed to be on the same footing. They have to be higher. They have to be of a greater station.
And, again, to put things in our perspective, that something that just happened this week, Nigel Farage, one of the architects of the Brexit, came out in support and endorsed Donald Trump.
Oh. Oh, jeez.
That should tell you everything you need to know.
It pretty much does. Pretty much does. Okay, so. So there's, as usual, there's a lot to unpack here, and I'm tired. I'm done with this. This has been a very heavy-handed kind of episode with lots and lots and lots of vitamins and minerals and everything that a growing political science major could possibly want in his diet. So we're definitely done with that. Stephen, since you happen to have a pick already in place, you, sir, get to go first while I scramble to find another one.
Again, the funny thing is, I actually spend a good chunk of my week trying to figure out what is my pick going to be for this week.
Well, I know what my pick is going to be. It's behind me, but I got to get a link for it.
That's fair. But for me, I've caught this channel a while ago, and I've just recently come back to it. It's called Vsauce 3. It is on YouTube, where they essentially take some very interesting questions and throw actual science at it to figure out how things actually would be or how you can attempt to pull this off. One of my favorites was, what would happen if you were punched by Superman? And they actually, went through all the calculations and everything else and go, okay, well, you know, assuming this, assuming these certain things, and let's just say that you would be reduced to your component atoms at the middle of a blast crater. Very fascinating. He's also done ones like, which are the deadliest Pokemon and why? Hint, Magikarp is one of them.
Interesting. So, okay.
can you splash pro? But he goes through all these different things and has even gotten like Discovery and other groups to support him for some things, like, you know, like a couple ones, like, you know, what happens when a meteorite strikes Earth? Or he actually goes over the Centralia fire in Pennsylvania and things like that. It's a very fascinating, it's very entertaining and very educational, and I highly recommend just going to them. And they tend to be 5-6 minutes. His bigger ones tend to be like 10 to 12. But they're incredibly fascinating, incredibly educational, and just incredibly neat to see some of the things get thrown at this guy as far as questions, and then the science behind the answers.
What if you were Shadrokan?
Yeah, that was, I saw that one too. That was, yeah, nasty.
Could you rip out a spine?
That one I actually have not seen.
Could you be Iron Man? Is Mario really evil? What if Captain America's shield hit you? Four logical paradoxes. Should you never wish to sleep again? Or immediately go to sleep? Your choice. Could you live forever? Well, maybe. Cool. That's some good stuff. I need to show those to my daughters. Excellent. That's a good pick.
I would be careful because some of the stuff they show, like when you did the, you know, the Pokemon that will kill you for the Magikarp one, he showed the guy who was testing how to eject from a, whether you could safely eject from an airplane and how fast you could go to take it. And they showed his results after attempting, basically doing a rocket sled at 35 Gs. It's in black and white, but you can see the damage he sustained in doing it. So sometimes, not depending.
Well,
but
you
for the
know,
most part, they're all great.
That's okay. Some of the things my daughter watches aren't great anyway.
All right, that's fair.
So
that's
yeah, it's all good. You know, it's a new culture. Yeah, it's just a thing.
Yeah.
Okay, that's very cool. Very cool. Okay, so I've got mine in there, but that's okay. So, what do you got there, Daniel? You've got something in there.
Mentioned earlier Shah of Shahs.
Ah, yes.
If you want to learn about the U.S. history with Iran, read this book. It's not expensive. I will warn you, it is dry. It is a dry and perspective text. However,
yeah, it gives you don't see any Audible on there. That's going to be rough.
It gives you all the context that you could want in a small volume. This is a good place to start. If you want to get an idea of why the West is hated, distrusted, and is a problem for Iran.
Oh, look, translated by from the Polish.
Yeah. But no. Worthy read. I suggest a good cup of tea with this.
Because
it can be dry. It's dated and it's a very specific perspective. But it's worth the reading.
The other son, the firstborn and the hope of his father's life, perished in mysterious circumstances. Treacherously killed, people say, by Savak and Shah's secret police. Not all of it's that dry.
No, there is some sensationalism to it. Again, perspective.
Perhaps we need a dramatized version.
History is better than what you can find on the BBC,
yeah,
or even HBO. Because I'll tell you this. I had to read it for one of my classes, which was the Politics of Revolution, back when I was attending UCF. It was also a suggested read for my Western Civilization courses. And if you want something a little more salacious after reading this, go and look up Pope Innocent III.
Your favorite pope.
Well, yes, he liked to invade countries, take property, and he took care of a number of his lovers, made one of them cardinal. So,
nice.
If you want to have a salacious, nice reading, read up on the popes. That is not a tame read.
The announcer is reading the personal data of each and the list of crimes that each committed. General Mohammed Zand gave the order to fire on an unarmed demonstration in Tabriz. Hundreds were killed. Major Hossein Farzan tortured prisoners by burning their eyelids and pulling out their fingernails. A few hours ago, the announcer says, the firing squad of the Islamic militia carried out the sentence of the tribunal against them. The hall feels stuffy and oppressed during this parade of good and evil absent ones. It's not all bad. It's not all bad. Cool. Okay, so Shah of Shahs. Excellent. Excellent choice. So we have that, of course, in the show notes. And now I have something geeky for everyone. I have recently decided to upgrade my my personal infrastructure, such as it is. And that means that I needed a larger SAN, a storage area network, or NAS, network-attached storage, depending on which you're actually thinking about. In this case, I imagine that the single device would be a network-attached storage device, but then it expands, and then I guess it would be a storage area network. So, in this particular case, I chose the Synology Disk Station 12-bay network-attached storage, the DS2415.
It looks intimidating.
It is actually a little bit intimidating, but it's pretty much fantastic. I have nothing but good things to say about it. The reason I decided to go with it was the Synology.
It looks like it's something you could find on a Star Destroyer.
Well, there's that, but no, it's this. It's the Synology Hybrid RAID features. It allows for multiple drive sizes and still having redundant storage with them. So, in the case of the box that is right here, dutifully adding a drive, the first four drives, 1, 2, 3, 4, are all 2 terabyte drives that it has inherited from previous systems. Then this drive is the second drive in a RAID that died. This is the replacement drive. And for some reason, the Rocket RAID that I have in the previous server is not allowing me to adopt the drive back into the RAID array. So I cannot repopulate it. So I have to move everything. And I have terabytes and terabytes and terabytes of data, so I needed something that I could be flexible with. So I'll be able to add the 8 6-terabyte drives to this guy, and yet add them to the RAID that already is included with these 4. And then, later on, I can pull one out and pop a bigger drive in and just upgrade on the spot. Ta-da! So when those 10-terabyte drives become a little bit more reasonable, I can upgrade. Now, if I choose to keep the ones that I have and not bother upgrading any drives that are already in service, the device here happens to have an expansion port. It also has 4 USB 3 ports so that you can attach printers. You can attach, it's running Linux underneath everything. So you can attach different drives like I have here, and you can just share them out and copy media to and fro as you need to, whatever you need to do. But they also have expansion chassis, full chassis just like this one, but without the processor. So basically, it's just a backplane, some fans, and that expansion port. So you just drop that in, and oh, look, you can add another 12 and then attach another one to that, another 12. So 36 total drives, all controlled by a single device. They do have one that's more powerful than this, because this is running an Intel Atom chip. So it's not the best, but it is quad core at least. This one comes with 2 gig of RAM, DDR3, so it's decent. But I can also upgrade the RAM, so I can take the top off and I can change out the chip if I want. But this one has the Synology hybrid RAID that allows me to do the things that I want to do personally. They have more advanced ones. This will also do iSCSI LUNs and various more enterprise-friendly features like that. If you have to have a very specific virtual machine, it is virtual machine and Docker compliant, so you can do all sorts of things. Just spin up an instant machine. It comes with one license for one Docker instance for 1 year, and then you can get new licenses through them for additional site licenses and things like that as you need to. Docker is a very interesting technology. I don't have time to go through it right now, but basically instead of bringing up an entire virtual machine with all the overhead that has, you're bringing up an instance of the core machine just enough to run the application inside the Docker platform. So say with Docker, you could have a Minecraft server or a World of Warcraft, you know, personal server or anything like that, you could just have that inside it and fire it up. Now, it doesn't really have the horsepower to do it. The other ones are running a bit better processors, but they don't have the Synology hybrid RAID. So I had to go with this one. Oh, well, too bad. But it does have a Plex server. It can act as an LDAP server, which would be your Active Directory alternative that works on Linux. You can get into the underlying hardware. You can do pretty much anything you want. It's just got them available. In fact, let me see here. I can show you what it looks like. Yeah, that's the one. I'll show you what is it called? I can't remember. The operating system of it looks like. And you can't see my password. Ha ha ha. It also has 4 gigabit RAID ports that can be, you can move them, you can have them connected to different switches. You can bond them all together. You can have them go off to different VLANs if you need to. You can have all that functionality. There's a package center that allows you to install different applications. I currently have Cloud Station, a wiki, a database server, PHP, the Plex Media server, but they also have their own apps. It can run as a surveillance system. So you can have IP cameras just direct to it, and it'll just store them all. It does have its own built-in media server, too. There's backup and line of business. There's built-in antivirus that you can have. Glacier, Amazon backup. It can run as a mail server. It can run some interesting spreadsheet applications. All sorts of things. It's an insanely versatile device. And almost all of these are, you know, fee-free. Strangely, if you wanted to actually read EXFAT format stuff, it costs you $4. I don't know why, but it was worth it because I had a drive that needed it, especially if you're in a Mac environment. It does have an iTunes server built in as well, so you can share all your stuff out to your Apple iDevices if you need to. There's Docker. It can run as a DNS server, the directory server, a contact management solution, a Git repository. If you happen to be a programmer and need revisioning support, you can have that on site. Radius servers, if you have a wireless infrastructure, because this is an enterprise class kind of box with all this features. Maybe not a very big enterprise. They have other things for that. But this will definitely run a small back office like a dream. Dream come true. A VPN server as well. Virtual Disk Manager. You can do all sorts of things with this. I mean, it's actually... It kind of makes me a little giddy. You might have noticed. Let's see. There's something else though. There's also, you can get underneath and you can install packages separately. You can add, CrashPlan is something that I use personally for online backup, and you can add that. It does exist, but it's not listed here. So I'm not sure what's going on with that. So it's very versatile. It's not super powerful, but it definitely makes up for it in its capabilities, its other capabilities. Let's see. So these are the volumes that I currently have. It is currently expanding, adding that 6 terabyte drive, which is down here, expanding it. It takes a long time to do. It's been working all day, but I'm also transferring things to the RAID at the same time that it's expanding the RAID. So this whole time that we've been working, it's been absorbing things from the existing server infrastructure so that I can kind of multitask. Though it takes longer than to do this, and it lowers the performance. But you know what? Screw it. I'm okay. I can do this. I don't know what the cost would be to have somebody like me come in and do this for a company. It would take a week, easily. Just to set up what you're thinking of doing. But if you're setting up from scratch and you don't want to pay big money for a back office server from Microsoft, this thing, it's mostly open source. And for the cost of the chassis, I mean, with the with Amazon, yeah, it's $1,300. But then you add your own drives. And you can add whatever size drives you want. If you just needed to start off with 2 drives, you could. And then once you've got them in, you can start your process, get everything going, and then as your business increases and you need more storage, you can add another drive, and then you've got more storage and more storage and more storage. And it can run your entire line of business directly from that. You can run your own website off that if you don't have too many visitors. You can definitely do that. You can run OS Ticket is an open source ticketing system for people like me. So you can run an entire ticketing website, and you can run a business for service of different companies right off that box. You can do amazing things with it. It's just like, what? It does everything. It's crazy. So I can't speak highly enough of it. I mean, so far, so good. It's doing really well. And the fact that it's still operating in this state while it's expanding the RAID and doing what it needs to do, basically it's just not going to give up. And I just have, you know, one drive fault tolerance. So if a drive goes down, I'll just pop in a new one. Before I actually add all the other ones, I'm going to yank out a drive and see if I can destroy it. Just see what happens so that I know what happens when I pop a new one in and see if it'll just rebuild on the fly. Because I've got enough drives to do that. In theory, what the Synology Hybrid RAID is supposed to do is if there is enough space, if I remove one drive, it should then rebuild on the existing drives to recreate the one disk fault tolerance. So then another one could fail. But it would take time to redo where everything is. And then it would just be the process of adding another drive back. So it's much more flexible and obviously much more capable than the system that I previously had. It's very small, obviously. You know, it's a foot tall, it's a foot deep, and a foot wide. You know, it's just a little... It's a cube of happiness for IT professionals. It's so pretty. You can also put in SSD drives to give it some performance boost. I think it'll take up to 4 of those, and it will then dynamically add them in and make them faster. Make your whole experience faster, putting things that need to be accessed quickly into there. And it even came with screws for that, too. But this guy, they have little caseless, screwless components to just drop in a drive. These are rubber grommets that add a little bit of vibration flexibility so you don't shake everything to bits. Of course, they recommend using NAS-capable drives like the Western Digital Red Series, which has a little bit more enterprise tolerance. But in my experience, as long as you're running a RAID, you really don't have to. Because then if one of those drives fails, you can just pop in another drive. The big difference with those is that the enterprise drives never go to sleep. That's the thing. The green drives power cycle themselves down. And then in a RAID array like this, they have to then power cycle themselves back up. Which is bad because then they're going to miss their cycle to get a read. So you have to turn all of those features off. And you can do it with on some of like the Western Digital Green stuff. You can overwrite the firmware and basically tell it to take that flag off. So you can do it, especially on the blues, and the blacks are already that they're the higher performance drives anyway. So you can definitely do that. There's the surveillance drives, which I think are the purple, and Blue Caviar, you can do that with. The greens, maybe not, but, you know, they're so cheap that I would avoid doing them anyway. Go with the higher price drives, just a little bit higher price, and then you'll get some better performance out of it. So should you have any questions about it, you know, drop us a line, and I'll answer some questions. But I will say that, as usual, the wonders of Amazon, the reviews are fantastic. I mean, this has 4.5 stars, really high review ratings, and lots of answered questions. It's really just the way to go. If 12 bay is not your thing, like you're not crazy like me and you need all this ability, you can also go with a 5 bay or an 8 bay. And it has pretty much the same functionality. These are just the desktop style. They do also have varieties that are fully rack mounted, redundant power supplies, you know, crazy stuff like that, if you're in for that. I chose that just for flexibility, and I like the look of it. And it's a little bit less expensive than the rack mount one, because then you have to get rails and things like that, too. So, there you go. That is the Synology Disk Station 12-bay network attached storage, the DS2415 Plus. Go get one. I highly recommend it. They're pretty darn cool. And, yeah, some of them get much more expensive, like the XS and things like that. That's the one with the better processor and things like that. But there's the expansion unit, and it's, you know, $200 less because basically it doesn't have the same overhead stuff. But it's otherwise identical. It looks the same. It's just going to come with a data cable to daisy chain off the back. In fact, it should. Yeah. Oh, just one. Maybe you can only add one. I don't know. I don't know. I'll have to look at that. They said that it could do two. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. But still, 24 drives for a small business, especially a home server. I mean, come on. I'm good to go for a long time. And with that, I think that's the end of the show. What do you guys think?
Good place to call it.
Good place. Okay. And where is... Ah, there's the end. Waiting for me to hear it, at least. Oh, come on. Things are just not working sometimes. Anyway. So, that is it for tonight. We'll be back live next Friday about 9:30 p.m. Eastern. In the meantime, the conversations continue on the web. Head over to ORLYRADIO.com. That's ORLYRADIO.com for all the links at the top of the page. And do like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Tumblr, Google+, and subscribe to the YouTube and the Twitch channel so you know when we go live. And of course, you can watch us live and join all the fun in the chat, just like Mama Van. Thank you very much for being here. Of course, you've already, you didn't want to hear about the Synology server, so bye-bye. Of course, you can watch us live, and all of that you can do from our webpage at ORLYRADIO.com. If you've stayed with us all the way through to the credits, how about you give us a hand? If you could have a few dollars to spare, or you could contribute to the Patreon, get early access to the show releases, and maybe some special perks here and there, follow the Patreon link on the webpage. That'll take you over to patreon.com/ORLYRADIO. You can also make one-time donations via the donate button, very cleverly named. And if you can't fit us into your rainy day funds, do us a solid, share the show, leave us a positive review on whatever platform you happen to find us on. iTunes, go over there. iTunes. We're always looking for new ideas for the show too. So how about you share what's on your mind and shoot us a note over to ORLYRADIOPodcast@gmail.com. Or if you're the more talkative sort, of course you are. How about you leave us a voicemail, 470-222-6759. It's always ready to take your call or text. Standard messaging rates apply. See office for details. Can't thank you enough for spending some time with us tonight. Until next time, this has been ORLY Radio, part of the Cowen Services Network. Music for the show was created by Kevin McLeod of Comptech.com. Thank you very much, Daniel. Thank you very much, Stephen, and we will see you all next week. Toodles! That's it. It's in the can.
Woohoo!
Yay!
Huzzah!